quick thought about the championship today and about this race? Quick thought about today's championship, Dale, in this particular race?
Well, you know, it's been a long year. It's been a good year for us. If that gets green flag here, we'll have that championship in the back. We're going to try to win the race.
Okay, good luck, Dale.
Joining Pat Patterson, a veteran of all of our TBS Sports broadcasts, veteran pit reporter Jerry Garrett with the rookie pole sitter.
Well, Davey Allison's been on the pole 5 times this year, including this race earlier this year, but it hasn't translated into victory for you yet. What are you going to do to win today?
Well, we're going to go out here and we're going to work hard all day to try to keep this car dialed in and try to put this Hamlin Star Thunderbird victory lane this afternoon. I'd like to give a lot of credit to Tony Price and Tom Arritt and Robert Yates for bearing with me this week. We've had a little bit of a shake-up at the shop, but things have turned out pretty well. At least we sit on the pole for qualifying. Now we just got to go try to win this race. Good luck today, Davey. Let's go topside now for Ken Squire, who's going to announce all the action today.
Thank you, Jerry. 492 laps, 500 miles the distance, and there's a lot more than a race at stake here today at Rockingham. A gentleman that can address that, Lake Speed, will be working in the booth with us. Well-known driver. Lake, how about this desperation time?
The pressure's definitely on at the Rock. You've got three drivers that are presently on the winner's circle. It's worth $250,000 to their team. If they don't win either today or the next two races, they lose it. And we've got several drivers out there that we're used to seeing in victory circle each year that haven't won in a while either. It's also worth $250,000 each to them.
A man who's built a lot of these cars, well-known strategist, guy who's followed Winston Cup Racing for eons, is also with us today, Johnny Hayes.
Thank you, Ken. There was a time at Rockingham you could just ride around, take it easy, just hope the car did okay, wait for that last second shootout. Well, that's changed now because there's a guy named Dale Earnhardt running these races, and if you relax, you're lapped in about 55 laps, so y'all stay tuned and watch them real close because Dale's coming.
Okay. The temperature's in the 60s, it's overcast, and we're ready to roll here at Rockingham's North Carolina Motor Speedway.
The AC Delco 500 is brought to you by AC Delco Automotive Parts. They don't just fit, they match. And by the Heartbeat of America, today's Chevrolet. And by the U.S. Armed Forces, it's a great place to start.
Forty cars rolling off pit road that have qualified within 1.5 seconds of each other. Difference of 8 miles per hour between first and the last car in qualifying, with a couple of provisional starters tagged on the back end of the field. Let's take a look now at the starting order for today's AC Delco 500. On the pole, it's Davey Allison for the fifth time this year with the Harry Rainier car. And flanking him is Dale Earnhardt, who will take the championship at the end of lap one. Going to row number two for today's race, Bill Elliott's there, the 84 champion, and alongside is Sterling Marlin. In row three, it's the two-time winner of this event, the Stavola Brothers car for Bobby Allison and Morgan Shepherd of Conover, North Carolina. In row four today, it's Ricky Rudd ready to roll and Kyle Petty in his Ford. Going to row five, Brett Bodine is there in the Ellington car and the three-time winner, Darrell Waltrip. In row six, it's Alan Kulwicki and Jeff Bodine. In row seven, Joe Ruttman is back, replacing Neil Bonnet and the 83 winner, Terry Labonte. In row eight, Buddy Baker's there, and alongside is Ken Schrader. For row nine this afternoon, Rusty Wallace of Missouri and Michael Waltrip from Kentucky. In row 10, it's Cale Yarborough, the four-time winner, and Dale Jarrett. Row 11 is Eddie Bierschwale, and with him is Benny Parsons of Bellamy, North Carolina, carrying our onboard camera. In row 12, it's Bobby Hillen Jr. and Kirk Bryant. Row 13, Phil Parsons and Harry Gantt. Row 14, Greg Sachs and Bobby Wowak. Row 15, Buddy Arrington and Curtis Markham. Row 16, Ronnie Thomas and David Simcoe. Row 17, Connie Saylor and Butch Miller. In row 18, it's J.D. McDuffie and Richard Petty, the three-time winner. Row 19, Hutch Strickland and Mark Stahl of San Diego, California. Going to row 20, Jimmy Means is there from Huntsville, Alabama, and Trevor Boyce. And finally, the provisional starters today, Dave Marcus taking the provisional start, and Steve Christman, Fort Wayne, Indiana. 42 cars ready to go in just one lap here at the AC Delco 500. Harold Kinder giving the indication to the field that we're one lap away. Four drivers have won this race from the pole. Lorenzen in 66 for Holman Moody, Donnie Allison in 77, Cale in 78, and Darrell Waltrip in 1981. Field preparing for a start, this time by Archie Long, the Grand Marshal of the race from General Motors, who has just shown off the colors of the new Dale Earnhardt Goodwrench car for 1988. Is now at the starter stand. He'll be dropping the flag on the field, going down the back straightaway before the largest crowd I have ever seen at the North Carolina Motor Speedway.
Well, it's a beautiful crowd today. The fans got a big thrill early because number three, Goodwrench, pulled right behind the wall, but it was Richard Childress driving the car.
Richard Childress, the owner of the car, longtime veteran driver. Field settling down for a start in turns three and four. Lake on the break. Who do you pick? The Ford on the inside, Chevy on the outside of Earnhardt.
My daddy always told me never get in a fight with a guy who ain't got nothing to lose. Dale Earnhardt, when he takes the green flag, gets $500,000.
Here they come, down to the line, ready to start, live here on the Superstation, the AC Delco 500 from the Rock. And as they whip under the green flag, Marchie Long and going to turn number one, it is even down to the bottom of the racetrack. Davey Allison cuts her loose, moves out in front by about 3 feet, now gets a car length advantage over Earnhardt. Surprise on the start, back straight away. In the third spot moves Bill Elliott, and Sterling Marlin is in fourth. 1987, Winston Cup champion, $500,000 richer right now. Car number three, Earnhardt, champion for the third time. Fireworks in the air for Dale Earnhardt, the new champion. The fireworks in the track look like this. It's Ford in front, Chevrolet in second, and Ford in third in the back straightaway. Better than $400,000 at stake in this afternoon's event, but as we mentioned earlier, a lot more at stake. We'll be going back. A big crash in turn number three. It's the car number one, Bodine, sliding, spinning, evasive action. It almost caught up Darrell Waltrip. I think he stuck through.
With some tremendous driving by several cars. They just waited, let him slide down out of the way, and we lost no one, and here comes Bodine back around right now.
That just gives you credit to the guys out there, because that was a phenomenal situation right then when a guy locks it up right in the middle of the field and nobody catches him.
He started ninth. This number one started ninth and spun, was sideways across the track in front of the field, and here's how it looked just moments ago up here in the corner. There you see the 17 car and the 11 just barely getting through. Waltrip in yesterday's race was not so fortunate. Right there in turn three and four in the most incredible Grand National race we've seen in years, he was in trouble. We'll get back to that story later, too. So, as you took, I'll take a look at the picture from inside Benny Parsons' car. Under caution after only three laps complete as they come to the line. More in a moment. Well, there you see the analysis of this mile track, just slightly over a mile on which they're running as they get ready to go back under green with four laps complete, five as they come to the line this time. And Dale Earnhardt from that second place begins to look on the inside of Davey Allison. It is not to be. Earnhardt, the national champion, as this race came underway. And he is the first driver to do a three championship title in the shortest period of time, just 9 years. Pearson, it took 10, Lee Petty, 11, Richard and Waltrip, 13 years, and Cale, 16 years to win three titles. And number three, Earnhardt, has done it in just 9 seasons. It looks like there's lots more to come. Down they come out of turn number four. Davey Allison builds a bit of a lead, and it is Elliott now beginning to exert some strength and showing himself able to run underneath Earnhardt as they go down into turns one and two. There's the field looping into the back straightaway.
Well, you notice Dale Earnhardt took a little higher line that time and cut the space. So I think he's going to try to run the car a little higher, keep the RPMs. Here he goes, trying to make a move on Davey, but he is taking a different line.
If you notice, he did that same line yesterday in a sportsman race, and it was very, very beneficial to him as the race wore on. As the track got slick down low, everybody else had to try to race where Dale was already running.
Four to the bottom. Right there, number 28, Davey Allison, winner of two races this year. Fifth time this season he's been in the pole. Right behind him comes Earnhardt. And flanked right on the rear bumper is number nine, the winner at Charlotte, Bill Elliott, coming to the inside. Here they are, three strong. Now make it four as they come back to the line. And as they cut across, number 15, Ricky Rudd is there.
Absolutely. Ricky Rudd started seventh place, and he seems to be the car right now that is showing the most potential.
Ford's up there. Three of the first four Ford automobiles, and Rudd is really in the hunt. He wants this one bad.
Absolutely. Like I said, the pressure's on a lot of guys out here. Ricky's moving to another team, but he really wants to show himself. He has nothing to lose. He's another one of those drivers.
I think Ricky Rudd's probably trying to put pressure on the fella that's going to relieve him, because Ricky is driving hard.
Here's Richard Petty on the move in car number 43, and he has really been storming the long two drives. Remember, he started way back when I was in the 25th. Now you're riding with Parsons. This is Benny Parsons, and the battle and the view from the Folgers car with our Superflow in-car camera as he hustles along right behind number 43. Back in the field. Back with the number 35 car. There you see Parsons. Back to the leaders, and there are the front four. Tight together. Earnhardt knocking on the door. Will he try to push that GM product up in front of the Ford here? Or is he willing to sit on it at this point?
Well, I think Dale will sit on it a little bit, but he's never had that reputation. I'm looking forward to seeing him going to the front, or at least working on Davey's mind.
Well, I really think everybody's missing the picture here. Ricky Rudd is coming on like gangbusters. His car is glued to the racetrack, and as we see right there, he's easing right on by Dale, and I think that Davey Allison is going to have him in his rearview mirror right on his bumper any second.
You see the front of the field, the top four, and there you see the Brett Bodine car, which spun earlier, the Ellington car. We asked him how slick this track was a little earlier. This is what Brett told us.
The cars are real slick. We just can't seem to get a hold of the racetrack. Everybody's having troubles. I've never seen so many springs and shocks and sway bars change during the week of practice as I have this time at Rockingham. You know, I really feel that you're going to have to manhandle the thing. You're going to have to slide it around. You're just going to have to do the best you can with what you got. Don't worry that it's not hooked to the racetrack. Just go out and drive the heck out of it. You know, try to get up there as far as you can.
Well, Brett Bodine slid that car around on the third lap of this race. In fact, slid it all the way around. They brought the car down to pit road, changed all four tires, could not find any problem with the car. But the handling that Bodine alluded to is a really complicated problem here this week. The track is more slippery than the drivers have ever seen it before. Compounding that problem for the race today is the fact that virtually all the practice was done under very warm, sunny conditions, which makes the track even looser. Today, it's overcast and cool. There was a tremendous amount of guessing going on in terms of the chassis setup. I think Bodine here and his crew may have guessed it wrong, but the leaders are running those different lines as they're trying to sort out how their cars are handling.
Brett Bodine in 33rd position currently. Here are our leaders another time, and there you see the battle for second. Fading up through, there's number 28. Now you see the interval back to second place. Earnhardt on that high line. He's followed by Elliott, and right in there is number 15, Ricky Rudd, now into third place. Elliott back to fourth. Again, you have Fords running 1, 3, and 4. Running in fifth is Morgan Shepherd, sixth Sterling Marlin, seventh Alan Kowicki. Going eighth is Jeff Bodine, ninth is Allison, tenth Labonte, 11th Ruttman. Ruttman on the move, 12th is Baker, 13th is Darrell Waltrip, and 14th is Ken Schrader. Lake Speed.
It's real interesting right now. As you notice, their cars are seemingly running all over the racetrack. What the individual drivers are doing is trying to find out where on the track their setup is best suited for. And it's obvious that it's different for different drivers. And this is where the real pros get into being able to both run the same speed, yet just completely different characteristics.
Rear end on number 3, Sash Agelil up in turn number 2. He gathers it back up, and Ricky Rudd stays third. Look way down to the bottom of the track, as Lake was pointed out, is that number 9 car of Elliott. And look at Morgan Shepherd coming on.
Well, Morgan ran great yesterday, and Morgan's coming back again. I think that running that race yesterday certainly helped all these people that are running today, because they started out with the same line they finished with yesterday. Now everyone has come back to that line.
It really is, Johnny. I think that, you know, we've noticed that Dale was the first one to take off to it. I noticed yesterday afternoon in the late practice sessions, those same drivers were practicing up there.
Now, let me tell you, yesterday, what a race we saw. Morgan Shepherd won on a photo finish. They had to take a look at the pictures that NASCAR generates to be positive about who won, and Shepherd in the final moments. We'll have more on that on the GM Goodrich update later in the program, but Shepherd came on and won it yesterday and came from behind to do it in the very last lap. It was a dramatic run. Davey Allison stays in front of that number 28. There's a big story developing in this car. His longtime friend, since he was just a kid coming to the races, when his dad used to park it in the infield while Bobby Allison went racing. He played with a kid from Charlotte, North Carolina, named Joey Knuckles. Davey used to say, I want to be a driver, and Joey said, I want to be the best mechanic there is. They've been teamed together all year, won four poles, two races, but now Knuckles has been fired, and several other members of the team have disappeared. And with some of the older gang that is now running that team, and they put him on the pole. We'll get back to that later, but there is a major shakeup in car number 28, Davey Allison, currently in the lead. Davey, how did you get the edge on everyone in this car setup?
That's a hard question to answer. You know, there's a lot of given that you have to deal with and not many variables. So right now, I think the biggest thing is I just need some more experience on this racetrack and a Winston Cup car to kind of get the feel of it a little bit better.
Well, there you see those leaders hustling down into the corner. And there is number 71, Marcus, back in 24th. Now, remember, he was a provisional starter in 42nd position. And from Benny Parsons' viewpoint, that's the look as he has an overview here from inside the Folgers car with our Superflow camera. He's trying to go around Dave Marcus as they come around this banking. But Marcus is able to hold the position. Dave Marcus in car number 71, trying to get himself back in this thing, had to take a provisional start. We're going to see a lot of drivers having to rely on that kind of thing in 1988 with a number of super teams that are being developed for Winston Cup racing. And we'll talk more about that later, too. We're going to get some time this afternoon in this four-hour-plus usual grind. Let's go back to the lead as Dave Marcus continues to fight for 24th with the car of Benny Parsons. And here you see those leaders. We have a swap with the leadership for the moment. Car number three, it is Earnhardt out in front, dropping back to second. Goes Davey Allison, bottom of the racetrack, and he tries to counter with a move low.
Well, I think Dale worked him, and he waited until the tires went away a little bit, and Davey's car wouldn't stick like it would. Now, I think Dale has him where he wants.
Now, let's take a look and replay at that lead change. Davey Allison, as we were back there following the exploits of Marcus cutting through the field. See them moving down through, and on the outside, it was where car number three maneuvered and came up through to take the lead.
There's one thing I think you'll notice is kind of interesting. The guys that have been running for years and years, nothing to take anything away from Davey, but the guys that have been running for a long time are already up in the high groove. Not only do you not wear the tires as bad there, but you don't have to deal with a lap car. As we just saw, Davey got really kind of picked off by a lap car because he's running in a lower groove and he's got more interference.
Ford's running second, third, and fourth. Chevrolet is out in front, being driven by Dale Earnhardt. And more live action on the Superstation from The Rock, North Carolina Motor Speedway, after these messages.
Petty for me. We're back live at North Carolina Motor Speedway in Rockingham, where rim riding Dale Earnhardt has taken the lead from our pole sitter, Davey Allison. Want to take you back a couple of days, show you how Allison came to sit at the head of the field here this afternoon in that number 28 automobile, that Ford Thunderbird, romping and stomping around here in qualifying. Earnhardt had posted the quick time, but then Davey came out under hot, sunny conditions, and he scorched this place with a 145.6 mile per hour lap to take the Busch pole. This is nothing new. It's his fifth Busch pole of the 1987 season. He's locked up a spot in the Busch Clash, which will kick off next year's season down at Daytona. Bill Elliott still leads with 7 points. That moved Allison out of a tie with Terry Labonte. Cole Whitney, champion Earnhardt, has only one pole this year, but 11 victories to go along with it. $25,000 to the guy who wins the most Busch poles this season, and the guy who looks like he wants that money is Bill Elliott. Now let's find out who's running up front. Ken?
Well, up in front, it's Dale Earnhardt on the high side, continuing to show those yellow and blue colors. We learned today it'll be for the final time. Goodrich colors, silver and black, go on number three for 1988. Same colors he's running his Grand National car. And as the battle continues here, Davey Allison stays in second. Ricky Rudd is in third. Elliott is in fourth. Morgan Shepherd in fifth. Terry Labonte in sixth. And Alan Kowicki in seventh. A great run being made up in front of the early going. It's a typical Earnhardt old-fashioned junior Johnson kind of run. Stand on it till you win or blow it.
Well, I tell you, this racetrack turned into almost a one-lane racetrack. I've never seen them run this high, Lake. They look like they're all almost hitting the wall.
Well, it reminds me of Michigan when the track was worn out up there, you know, the pavement. When you can't get a hold of it, you've got to try to run the line where you have to turn the least corner. That happens to be as close to the wall as you can get, and that's exactly where Dale's running. He's scared me three or four times when he's thrown up dust. He'll have that whole thing swept off before this day's done.
But there's a lot of marbles up there, and as you lose the bite in those tires, there's a pretty good chance you're going to be right on the edge.
Well, it's on the edge for sure, but what they have to do is they work up slowly and they dust the track as they go. They continue to sweep the marbles away, but you can't just run up into it or else you'll be in trouble.
Well, here's a couple. Buddy Baker's Oldsmobile trying to fend off number 75, and Joe Ruttman is aboard. Remember that Neil Bonnet is home watching with a broken leg after a serious crash at Charlotte, North Carolina. Neil down in Bessemer, Alabama. Everyone here wishes you well. Wishes you were here today driving that car. Joe Ruttman giving it a very good ride. Nothing to lose for him.
You can see how hard those fellas are racing. They're really getting after each other and have been for several laps. The reason they are, they're only about a third of a lap from getting lapped. Earnhardt is coming so strong, and he's after some of the best cars on the racetrack. So as we predicted, here comes Dale.
That's what you said, John. You can't wait a moment with Earnhardt pushing as hard as he is, or he'll put the whole field down. That's 11th and 12th position scooting by.
Not only do they have to deal with Dale, but they got to be dealing with the lap cars and the slower traffic, too. And this is what really compounds their problem. Not only do they have an Earnhardt out there that's running superb, but he's doing it with a blue wave over flag in front of him where they're having to fend for themselves.
Back up front, here's number three, Earnhardt, turning laps at 136 miles per hour, staying out in front, putting a lap on car number 64, which I believe is Connie Saylor today. Feel whipping down out of turn number four, and as they come by, Davey Allison stays in that same interval between himself and second and the leader. Ricky Rudd maintaining third. This has always been called a poor track, but the last 4 years in a row, it's been all Chevy, John Hayes.
Well, I'll tell you, there were a lot of tracks that were poor tracks, and Richard Childress' team has hit a special combination that has worked for them everywhere they go, and really, it's the only Chevrolet that has dominated. You can see there's a bunch of Fords up there with him. So I just think it probably is Dale Earnhardt and Richard Childress' race team, and Dale pulled right up on the bumper of the 35 car.
Now you're getting a little bit of an interval of second place there. Not very much of one. I think Davey's willing to sit on it for the present time. Robert Yates, well-known engine man, taking over as the chief mechanic and giving the orders. And I'm sure that he and Davey are really tight on what to do out here.
Well, Lake Speed explained to me earlier why some people can sit on it. Davey's car's running well enough that he can protect his car a little bit and not worry about getting lapped.
From the Folgers car with our Superflow in-car camera, you're watching as car number three, Earnhardt, pulls around and puts a lap on Benny Parsons. Parsons back just outside the top 20. And Earnhardt is setting an incredible pace, as you see from the Superflow camera.
Johnny, you're correct, but I tell you, there's very few cars out there, as you notice, that enjoy that capability of being able not to be perfect and still keep up. Davey and the next few cars there are obviously have settled into a groove. They've settled into a pace that they're running. They know that Dale's getting away from them, but they're not scared that they're going to get lapped.
There's car number 75 on the outside, and here's Darrell Waltrip down on the inside. Waltrip making a move underneath Ruttman, and it is Waltrip pulling up a spot. That will put Waltrip into the 11th position. Drops Joe Ruttman to 12. Baker has fallen to 13. Joe Ruttman giving it everything he's got up here on the outside. Ruttman seems to be very relaxed this week with nothing to prove out here.
Probably as kicked back as you could, any race driver here could ever possibly be, because I have nothing to prove. I know I'm not going to be a date for more than three. No matter how good I do or how poor I do, I know my position. So I'm not trying to impress anyone. I'm just trying to win that first Winston Cup race for Joe Ruttman. And I accepted the opportunity because I just know that I can do it. I just have to prove it to myself, and when I do it to myself, I'm obviously proving it to everybody else.
Joe Ruttman replacing the injured Neil Bonnet, who broke a leg in the crash at Charlotte. Right leg. First, they reported it was a hip, not the case. Leg, and he's out for the rest of the year. Now, look at that Earnhardt car climbing, just clinging to that handrail on the outside.
Was that awesome? He just drove right by Bobby Hillen and Dale Jarrett and is gone, and they're not even in the picture, Harley.
I guarantee you, the situation right now, I've been in it many times, the guys that are running on the low part of the track are just barely getting back into throttle. They're just feathering it, because if they just jab that pedal down, the rear end will come out from under them. The track's too slick down low. That outer groove, Dale's back into throttle up there in the middle of the corner, and his car just romps off that corner.
One of the cars that's really running is Richard Petty's number 43. Remember, we talked about him starting in 36? Well, right now, he is in 19th position. He's won this race on three occasions, 68, 71, and 76. 76, the last year he won it. When he did, he defeated Lenny Pond that year, who came in second place, and some kid, some unknown named Darrell Waltrip, finished third.
Well, I'll tell you, this track today, the conditions, as we see the rim ride, we all know that Richard Petty's been known for it. These track conditions are ideal for Richard Petty.
Well, Harry Gant's also a rim rider, and he's having a good run today. And he slid sideways a couple times, got her straightened back out, but Harry Gant's had a good run today also.
Anybody that runs up there is going to slip and slide and get sideways from time to time. That's part of the territory. Morgan Shepherd is another rim rider that we've known that's had a history of it that's been very successful today, too.
Hold on. Look at this. Here is, on the 48th lap, Earnhardt ready to try and lap Richard Petty. Petty just trying to get up in that groove and hold him back a little. Earnhardt may dive to the inside right here and take a shot to go around him and put him a lap down. It is all Earnhardt, and it is awesome, the performance of Earnhardt in the early going. He is the night, if you're just joining us, as they started the race, he became $550,000 richer. He is the 1987 champion, third time in his career. The only man to win as a rookie back in 1979 and then come back the following year and take the title. Dale Earnhardt, the man, continues to draw away from everyone here. Currently in second place is Davey Allison. In third is Morgan Shepherd. And in fourth is Ricky Rudd. Richard Petty just being overrun, going down a lap. Richard Petty, can you win this race?
Well, we've run a lot of races here, and we have been running a lot better lately. And I think everybody is sort of like what we are. It's just one of these days we're going to do it. We can't run that good that long and not win some. So, this could be the day.
Live on the Superstation, you're watching the AC Delco 500 from the North Carolina Motor Speedway, one of the toughest, most brutal tracks there is, because it's really a bowling alley. There's no place to go. Any kind of trouble, and it usually collects 7-8 cars at a time.
Ken, one thing, too, it works against the drivers right now. When we have a situation where the race starts and we run initially a long time under green, the guys have to guess at the race setup before this race starts. They think they know what the conditions are going to be, but there's no way to really know. The guys that guess right look great right now. The guys that guess wrong, they're a lap down right now. As the first yellow stop we get, the guys going to have the time to adjust the cars, we can see a whole new picture.
Rusty Wallace back there in 18th spot, and car number 3 just motored by. Now take a look at number 5. Here's the story. This guy is running. You're looking at Jeff Bodine, and he is flying to the field. He has picked up about 5 positions in the last 12 laps, and he currently is showing in the 10th spot. Bodine, who's had his share of misfortune, a sportsman race, or rather Grand National race, at Charlotte Motor Speedway just 2 weeks ago, upside down, 600 feet, destroyed the car, came back, wrecked the next day with his brother early in the going. Then, yesterday, problems again in the race. He has had a monkey on his back, and he's trying to get that situation straightened out here this afternoon. It is a must-win situation for Bodine over the next 3 races if he wants to stay in the winner's circle, Johnny Hayes.
Well, yes, and by the new numbers we just received from NASCAR, they have taken the 5 car off of the winner's circle for the remainder of the year, and the number 17 car has been put on. And as you well know, there's going to be some changes in teams in that area, so I think that's why that decision was made.
You're watching Jeff Bodine, who is currently running in 10th place. What about it, Jeff Bodine? Will bumping and banging be an issue here?
I hope it isn't a major issue, at least with me. I've been beat up, knocked around, shoved around, flipped over, sliding around enough this year. I don't want any more of that.
We're down to 3 cars in the Levi Garrett shop. We have 3 races left, so I guess we can make the year out without having to go build a new car.
Bodine, intense and on the move, also pulling up now.
Car number 26 on the roll. It's Morgan Shepherd by number 2. That
continues to just mow through the crowd. He just drove right by Kenny Schrader, and he's coming up. This is one of those situations, folks. As I said earlier, Earnhardt can land this field if you don't watch out. Everybody out there is hoping for a caution, most of all Harry Gant and Phil Parsons, because Earnhardt's coming up on them quick, and they want to get the opportunity to go in there and get those cars adjusted.
You realize the next three cars in a row in front of him have all won this race in the last few years. So, this gives you an idea of the quality of competition that's getting mowed down early in the race.
There you watch the Earnhardt car. The battle continues to develop further back, trying to move in here. It is Morgan Shepherd on a roll. In the lead is Earnhardt, but behind him, as we check that interval, come two cars now beginning to battle for the second position. It is Davey Allison, bottom of the track, and on the outside comes Morgan Shepherd, who's moved into third. They come to the start-finish line, and as they roll down to the turn number one, there you see the green car on the outside making the move. Morgan Shepherd picking up a spot, going to second place. Boy, does he look stout for the Kenny Bernstein team.
Well, Morgan Shepherd certainly has something to prove to everyone. I think most of you fans know that Morgan Shepherd has lost his ride for next year. He won the race yesterday in a photo finish with Jeff Bodine, drove a great race, a comeback race, and here he is now heading toward the front. He said before the race started, I'm going to win this one for my little girl, and I sure wouldn't count him out. Morgan's a tough customer, too.
He was some tough customer yesterday, winning in a photo finish, working toward the 60th lap, and look at Shepherd moving away from Davey Allison. So now we have a Buick in the second, a Chevrolet leading, and a Ford in third, Lake Speed.
Davey's going to keep up in this race the way the thing's unfolding right now. He's going to have to move his line up and get up there in that high lane if he's going to keep up. I think he's just working his tires too hard running that lower line.
Checking behind Davey Allison, we find Ricky Rudd in fourth. Elliott's back to fifth. Terry Labonte, sixth. Alan Kowicki, seventh. Bobby Allison, eighth. Kyle Petty is in ninth. Jeff Bodine is in 10th, and Darrell Waltrip 11th with Joe Rutland 12th. If you're just joining us, one early caution. Brett Bodine sideways, turn three after starting ninth. Nobody collected, and he was able to continue in the race. There is the leader, Earnhardt, and from Benny Parsons' viewpoint with the Superflow Motor Oil's in-car camera and the Folgers car, you get an idea of what he's looking at. And we'll be back with more in a moment.
Here at North Carolina Motor Speedway, I want to talk about hard chargers. True Value Hardware Store hard chargers, and the name we talk about is Dale Earnhardt. The True Value people put up a $50,000 bonus for the end of the year for the hardest charger of them all, and $5,000 for each race. It works like this. You lead a lap, you get 5 points. Second gets four, three, third, fourth place, two, and fifth place, 1 point for every lap of the race. So to score hard charger points, you got to get up front and stay there. Earnhardt is the runaway leader in the season standings. Elliott, Labonte, Wallace, and Rudd are all locked in the battle for the bonus money, and of course everybody is scrambling for the $5,000 here this afternoon. Again, Earnhardt is the True Value hard charger for the 1987 season. We've had a change in position here. Davey Allison is not up on that board, but he's been a charger here today. At the moment, he's charging backwards. We're going to try to find out why as we go to pit road and Pat Patterson.
Robert Yates is a crew chief on the car. Robert, is there a problem on the car, or is it just simple race wear at this point?
Well, no, the car is actually a little bit on the tight side, and we're running the low groove. The traffic seems to be more of a problem in that low groove. We need to get in. We'll make some changes, but we're in pretty good shape.
Okay, that's the story from Davey Allison's pit. Back up to you, Ken.
Working up toward the 70th lap now, Davey Allison has fallen back into fourth and is falling toward the clutches of Bill Elliott at this time. With 68 complete, Earnhardt first, and Dan Carter's True Value money. Looks like he has that one all bagged up and ready to take home. At Morgan Shepherd, I'll tell you how hard he's been charging. Only 12 cars in the lead lap, and the car back in 12 is the Joe Rutman car, the one that was scheduled, the Raymock Racing Team car for Neil Bonnett. At this point, he is trying to stay in that lead lap. He'd like a caution.
Well, Ken, there were a lot of cars out there a while ago just begging for a caution so they could repair their cars. But now the situation's changed. Those people are saying, let's hope it stays green so Earnhardt will lap everybody. It'll be a lap by himself, and then we, the rest of us, can race among ourselves for position. We don't want to get caught.
Johnny, you sound like you've been in the car before.
Want to let him go for a while?
Yeah, car owners have that feeling too, because they know it don't matter if you're lap down, the sponsor and everybody's looking.
Right.
There you see the Bodine car, number five. And we've got Davey Allison on pit road. Allison pulling in as Bodine continues to clip through the field in ninth. Davey Allison locks it up, slides to a stop. And there's the crew, Price, Yates, the rest of the team over the top. Let's go to the pits.
Davey Allison has the car down, and they're changing the left side tires. This could be a situation where they're trying to find out if they may have had a tire going down, or they're losing so much time on the racetrack, he's lost four or five positions. This obviously had to be done. They're going to lose some more valuable time as he's down and away.
20 seconds, and he's away after that report from Pat Patterson. Davey Allison coming back on, making that adjustment at the 71st lap, at lap 71. Back on the track, and here is Earnhardt, leading by 6 7/10 seconds over Morgan Shepherd, Ricky Rudd in third, Elliott in fourth, Terry Labonte in fifth. Think that car can sustain that kind of pace all afternoon, John?
Well, he's done it before, and I certainly wouldn't count him out. He did the same thing in the Sportsman race yesterday and did have problems. Looks like Allison's coming back in.
A second pit stop early, unscheduled for car number 28, back on pit road.
I'd say that's an equalized tire, and they tried one side, and it didn't work. What about that leg?
Most likely, Johnny, because the car, you know, notice that the tires are up, they're not down, so equalized tires about wouldn't have to be.
For the uninitiated, let's go into the business of an equalized tire.
Well, we have an inner liner tire. We have a safety shield is what they call it. So there's actually two tires with two different sets of air pressure. The inner tire, of course, being about 20 pounds higher than the outer tire. If you have a flat in the outer tire, you don't go all the way down to the rim. What happens when it equalizes is if the inside tire has a flat, it lets the excess air, that 20-pound differential, go to both of them. The inner tire will begin to flop around inside and cause the whole tire wheel assembly to become extremely out of balance.
That last pit stop was 15 seconds, and Davey Allison falls three laps down. Now there's car number nine. There's Elliott, and right with him is Terry Labonte. Labonte has just moved around and taken fourth position. Terry Labonte on a roll up into the fourth position. Bill Elliott back to fifth as they scoop beneath Rusty Wallace. Here they are in fourth. Davey Allison is running very slowly, bottom of the racetrack, and something is amiss on car number 28 as it approaches turn number three. Meanwhile, watching this scramble, there's number 90, Schrader, about to go a lap down to Terry Labonte and Bill Elliott. Davey Allison, for the third time, is coming on pit road, this at the 76th lap. Lap 76 of 492, and Davey Allison is in another time.
It appears he's going to go behind the wall. They must have something that tires could fix.
Back to the garage area goes car number 28, Davey Allison, out of it. And I believe that's the first car down this afternoon. That's the first car out. And we expected this thing to be wreck-strewn and difficult with low temperatures, hard tires. Not the case.
Believe me, the day is not over, Ken.
Well, this is a slick racetrack. I tell you, it looks like a roller coaster to me. The cars are going everywhere, three different groups, and I don't know how they haven't all hit each other yet.
You wait till they do have a caution flag, and you get these guys that are lapped down, get their cars adjusted, and you're going to see some people going for blood on those restarts trying to get their laps back. It's not over, believe me.
What are you going to do about running hard tires on a slippery track, Dale Earnhardt?
Well, it's going to be a little rough, I think. It's going to be a situation where if you get the right combination of tires and be consistent all day, I think you'd be tough to beat. But I haven't put a set of tires on that really acted the same, so we're going to have to really stay on top of the tire stagger and adjust with the car and the track all day long. I think everybody's going to have to work hard to beat the pace of all day.
Riding roughshod at present time, Dale Earnhardt over the field.
Bless poor old Dale Earnhardt's heart. He got them tires. It's just not real good. They won't run real good. He just lapped the whole field almost. I hope he don't get a good set.
No, I tell you what, I believe they hit the right combination on the start of the race. There's no doubt about it. They're running extremely good. He's flirted with disaster lots of times, but it seems to be one of those control flirts.
Well, that was a control flirt right there.
Absolutely.
Well, I think old dirt racer like Earnhardt is. I know all you dirt racing fans, you love to see cars sideways. Well, Dale will put them sideways for you, and he's fun to watch.
Ray Cooper in the Greensboro, North Carolina News Record wrote earlier this week, Earnhardt is a polished man from the school of hard knocks, and that really sums him up, doesn't it?
I thought they call that ball peening.
Dale Earnhardt staying out in front as we close through 82 laps in our live coverage here on the Superstation of the AC Delco 500. More shortly. Again here as we continue to watch Dale Earnhardt, 83 laps in. Morgan Shepherd in second, Ricky Ruggs third, Terry Labonte fourth, Bill Elliott fifth, Kowicki sixth, Kyle Petty seventh, Jeff Bodine eighth, and it's Bobby Allison ninth, Darrell Waltrip tenth, and back now is the car number 15. You're watching Ricky Rudd in third and Terry Labonte on the move.
Really come to life here lately. I think the track conditions and his tires, it happens from time to time that as you run, the tires will grow. And the stagger on his set of tires has obviously changed from what it was at the first of the race, but it's changed for the good. We've seen some guys out here that obviously their tire change has gone the other way.
Putting a lap on Harry Gant. Let's join Jerry Garrett down in the garage, Jerry.
Well, we're down here right now with Davey Allison, and we're checking what the problem is. It seems like the left rear axle is broken, Davey. Is that what the problem was?
We burned up the rear end. Wasn't doing the job to cool the grease. And since we're so many laps down, we're not racing for the points. We don't want to go back out there and be in everybody's way.
You've been out there on the track. You can tell us firsthand how slippery is it today. Is it being cloudy helping us?
It's bloody slippery.
Okay, well, the best word we can get from someone who's been out there. It's terrible.
Leader is Petty. The interval is being chopped into by Morgan Shepherd, and Earnhardt elects to pit right here. Pat Patterson is standing by on pit road. The Richard Childress pits. Dale Earnhardt is there.
And the World Championship pit crew team goes to work on the right side, Ken. They'll change two tires over there, get a load of fuel in as Earnhardt, no chassis adjustment on the car. Earnhardt sits patiently and waits as he'll be down and away here. This is probably the most outstanding pit crew in the business. Behind Earnhardt, also Darrell Waltrip will bring his car in on this lap, and he too will get service and get back out.
17 3/10 seconds, and Earnhardt is back underway. He has never won this race. Now you see Waltrip on pit road. Darrell Waltrip ducking in, hoping to get his luck rolling once again with car number 17. He's away. Excellent stop on Darrell Waltrip. So it's green flag pit stops. And we're watching Joe Ruttman also come on pit road. There's your new leader in the green Buick of Kenny Bernstein, the Quaker State colors, for Morgan Shepherd now in front. We'll be back with more of the action from The Rock, North Carolina Motor Speedway, Winston Cup competition after these messages.
Here in the STP Pit Communications Center in Rockingham, pit stops are in fact the story. Ricky Rudd, third place car, has just come on pit road. Right side tires and fuel will drop him temporarily out of the top three. Dale Earnhardt, who has dominated the race, has also pitted. Morgan Shepherd and Terry Labonte have not yet been in. They occupy first and second spots. We'll move Elliott up to third. They all will be coming in momentarily for fuel. And that is the story right now. All green flag pit stops. It's been a remarkably clean race here at The Rock, especially compared to yesterday. Today's demo derby, but still 300 laps to go. Ken?
93 laps are complete. Shepherd leading, Labonte second, Kowicki running third. That's right, Alan Kowicki, that little independent from Wisconsin, is in third spot in this battle. What a story he is this year. Now we're watching his car number 7. Kowicki pulls down the pit road. Let's see if Morgan's going to pit here. No, he elects not to. Morgan Shepherd, do you feel like Rockingham is a tough track to drive?
Rockingham is one of our tougher racetracks, like Dover and Bristol. Rockingham, you've got to really be in shape mentally because there's not much time between the turns. And then on top of that, you got to really be in shape physically because Rockingham just flat wears the driver down, and you got to try to stay sharp all day long. You better get a good night's sleep before you come to Rockingham, Ken.
Did you get a good night's sleep, John?
Yes, I did. My wife's at home watching on TV, and I want to assure you, Ann, I got a great night's sleep.
There you see Alan Kowicki coming back on the track. I think that was just out of the gas tank there, a little excess fuel rolling out of car number 7, Alan Kowicki.
I think a real interesting note here, that if this race continues
the way it is now with a lot of green flag racing. Morgan Shepherd's gas mileage and Terry Labonte's gas mileage could be a big, big point to deal with before this race is over. Let's go to Jerry here.
We're down here on pit road with Morgan Shepherd's first pit stop of the day. They're going to change to two right side tires, put in two cans of fuel, and I don't believe they're going to make any chassis adjustment whatsoever on this car. And they're away very quickly, 14 seconds.
Morgan Shepherd coming out after a 14-second stop, and there was a 14-second stop by Bill Elliott. The most competitive automobile racing in the world. Winston Cup competition live here on the Superstation. Number 11, Terry Labonte, now the leader. He's pitting. Let's see what his pit crew will do. For Terry Labonte, one of the all-time giants, Junior Johnson and Company, ready for Terry Labonte. Right side rubber going on the car. Terry Labonte, who won here in 1983. At one of the toughest tracks over which these cars compete, North Carolina Motor Speedway. Jeff Bodine, I believe, is inheriting the lead now, and Earnhardt comes back up to second on the board. We're approaching the 100-lap mark. So Labonte is away and rolling, and Earnhardt, who is being shown in second place at the moment, wheeling around Jimmy Means, car number 52. Jimmy stays right up there with him for a moment.
Well, Jimmy's had a good run this year, and has really impressed a lot of people. He got his big break at Charlotte, had a bad accident that was not his fault, and we sure hope Jimmy gets the big sponsorship deal.
He's got a sponsor right on there now, a vacuum cleaner.
He has Eureka, and we're just hoping that that Jimmy will get the help he needs, because next year, buddy, it's going to be tough making these races with 35 to 36 first-class cars with first-class sponsorship. It's going to be tough when you go to Richmond, Virginia.
Yeah, what about that, Lake? You go to a short track next year, they say there's 32 to 35 real super teams. The little independents like Means and McDuffie, hey, they may be history next year.
We're going to see some new things next year that we've never seen before. It's going to be some good teams and good cars going home and not making races.
Does that bother you?
Not me. I'm going to be up there in the front. I'm not worried about it.
It bothers me because mine may not. I'm going to have a hard time explaining.
Here they are out of the corner, and I believe this is a battle for the lead coming to the strike.
Morgan Shepherd has just taken the lead, folks, and I'm telling you, that car has really been steady here. I've been noticing it, really watching off the fourth turn. The cars normally twitch a little bit, and his car has been about the steadiest one coming off that corner out there.
One thing I want all you fans to watch closely, Dale Earnhardt will not intimidate or mess with Morgan Shepherd. I will assure you that, folks, because he is just as tough as Earnhardt, would not back off to a grizzly bear.
They are saying they are battling for second, and that Bodine has not pitted in the car number 5. I thought that he had come in, that I'd seen him come down pit road. So there is Bodine in car number 5 that they're pointing out as the leader at the present time from scoring.
And like I said before, if gas mileage has got anything to do with it, we were talking about Morgan, but Jeff's doing some phenomenal gas mileage right now.
Jeff Bodine being shown in the first position, Shepherd and Earnhardt battling for second. Boy, he's getting some real range at that position.
Well, historically, that car and that team has gotten good gas mileage, and that's one of the keys they have. And one of the key things here, if he stays out and a caution comes right now, he's probably lapped about half the people in the field, maybe all of them.
Labonte fourth, Ricky Rudd fifth. One caution thus far for 3 laps when Brett Bodine spun in turn number 3 right at the outset of the race, and nobody got into any harm out of that. It looked like it was going to be serious, but everybody took evasive action, was able to get through. So Bodine stays out in front. Jeff Bodine may have an edge on slippery tracks because he used to be a figure skater.
Oh, me. You're going to have to handle that one.
I used to skate a lot when I was a kid, but I used to fall down a lot, too. I've been falling down here lately. Just a couple weeks ago, Charlotte was probably one of my worst falls. 2 days in a row, I had bad luck, bad things happened. We're looking to get out of that slump, that little jinx we have, the monkey in her back. I think it's a gorilla, but they say it's a monkey. We're hoping to get out of it here at Rockingham.
Well, we're now being told that Jeff Bodine indeed did pit, and he is back. He is not the leader. The leader is Morgan Shepherd from the number 26, and Earnhardt is in second. We did see him come on pit road, and
I think the picture here really is a lot bleaker than it sounded, because Morgan's not very far from behind him right now, and he could be a lap down here for two very long.
So the situation is that number five has made his pit stop, and that means that the leader is Sheppard, with Earnhardt second, Labonte third, Ricky Rudd fourth, and Bill Elliott in fifth. And what a day for Morgan Sheppard, who won out here yesterday. Remember, the Goodwrench race report is coming up, and we're going to show you that finish from yesterday. It's unbelievable. It's one of the best races I've seen in years.
Well, the thing I love about it, Morgan, he runs great at Atlanta, Georgia. He's got that coming up. He's liable to win here today and go win at Atlanta and not have a ride. So I think there's a lot of car owners on pit road are saying, oh, me, Morgan might be my man.
Larry McReynolds, the crew chief on tenderhooks down on pit road, as Morgan Sheppard continues to roll out. Over 100 laps are now complete. I'd like to say a special hello to Dick Beatty's wife, May. Dick Beatty's done such a tremendous job for Winston Cup Racing, stewarding these cars in the garage here. I think he's probably one of the best liked people the NASCAR has had, and she's recovering from surgery and watching this today.
Nobody in racing is more loved than Mae Beatty. She is an inspiration to us all, and we love you, Mae, and getting well, and we'll see you at the racetrack. Hit Dick in the mouth when he gets home, because he's ugly to me.
Nice going. Off the in-car camera. There you are with the look from Benny Parsons, Folger's car, the Superflow Motor Oil's in-car camera. Giving you a glimpse of what Benny Parsons has seen in 15th place. Right in front of him in 14th is Sterling Marlin, and 13th is Cale Yarborough. Harry Gant is back in 16th now, and Greg Sachs just behind him in 17th. This coming at lap 110. Lap 110 of the 492 to be run here today. And as we move through our action-packed race, we're watching Morgan Sheppard continuing out in front with Dale Earnhardt, now playing bridesmaid. Back for more of the action here this afternoon. Oh, we got an incident up in turn two. It looks like Brett Bodine has spun once again, this time in turn two. Well, we're about, that's all it takes. You're ready to go to commercial, and bingo, you got action. And the back end, all torn up on the Haas Ellington car. The Bullseye Barbecue car comes in. Let's take a look at what happened out there. Blake, how about this one? Well, we didn't see what started it.
No, you couldn't. It was too early. You know,
sure saw what
had a tire go down, or just anything could have happened. It looked like it happened. Actually, the problem happened prior to getting to the corner.
Actually, he's blessed. That's the second time he's done a 360 today and hasn't been collected by anyone.
Well, he came right off the wall in the middle of everybody. Somebody did a beautiful job missing him, and I tell you, it's just one of those days, like we say, it's a slick racetrack.
Well, let's get a message now from the good folks making this possible on the Superstation today. We're under caution for the second time in the AC Delco 500. Ken Squire with you here at the North Carolina Motor Speedway. We're under caution for the second time today. Dale Earnhardt now appropriates the lead. And while we have a moment, let's take a look at a GM Goodwrench update, of which we'll have two or three for you this afternoon. And standing by is Bob Richards.
Thanks, Ken. You know, Rockingham isn't the only track alive with excitement this weekend. Out west at the Del Mar Fairgrounds, the Southern California Grand Prix is being held. Now, yesterday, Chris Cord helped Dan Gurney's Toyota team wrap up the GTO Manufacturers Championship with a win. Bob Earl was second, with Willie T. Ribbs pictured here in the number 99 Toyota third. Now, the GTU and GTP events are going to be held a little bit later on today. Kerry Visger in a Pontiac Fiero, the pole setter in GTU, while Chip Robinson in the Porsche 962, the top man in GTP. Incidentally, the first place money in GTP, $85,000. That's an IMSA record. Well, there was a lot less money up for grabs at Volusia County Speedway in Florida yesterday, but the racing was just as intense. The Florida State Championship on the line. Steve Moran, the late model champ. John Bradley, the new king of mini stocks. Well, that's it for this GM Goodwrench update. Let's go back upstairs to Ken.
Thank you, Bob. And in our next update, we'll let you take a look at that finish yesterday here at the Rock in the Grand National Competition. As we prepare to resume competition with 117 laps complete, something like that, 114, it's Earnhardt first, Labonte second, Ricky Rudd third, Bill Elliott fourth, running fifth, Kyle Petty, sixth, Darrell Waltrip, seventh, Davey Allison, eighth, Alan Kowicki, ninth, Jeff Bodine, tenth, Morgan Sheppard, 11th on the field, Joe Ruttman with one lap to green, 12th is Sterling Marlin, 13th, Bobby Hillen, 14th, Cale Yarborough, and running 15th is Rusty Wallace, and 16th is Phil Parsons. That's Bobby Allison in seventh place. I may have said Davey or Donnie or any of the other ones. Clifford,
I think
there's so many Allisons racing
these days. I believe that's Davey's father.
Davey's father. There's car number 7, Alan Kowicki, back in on pit road. The man currently running in 8th place. His Ford Thunderbird. Gosh, I hope that isn't trouble for him. One car he's run in 6 the last 7 races, and that's the same car that he bent up in Charlotte, North Carolina just 2 weeks ago at the Oakwood Homes 500. Foot comes down, he's trying to get back in here and get underway.
It looked like brake fluid bottles they were using there, so he may, this track can be very difficult on brakes, and it may be that Alan's cooked his brakes.
From Benny Parsons' view, with the Superflow Motor Oil's in-car camera. Getting ready for the start. You see, he's down on the inside. Lap cars are on the inside, and the cars in the lead lap are on the outside as we prepare for resumption. And let's stay with this on the start, give you an idea of what it feels like to come down the line. Kicks it up a gear. We're away. Back under green. Whoa. A little tight down there in turn 1. Away and running. And out in front, Earnhardt.
Back up in that lap, but he's got a hard way to go with Earnhardt.
Alan Kowicki was able to get on the track and to continue and stay in that lead lap, but he's now on the tail end of it and almost got trapped.
Yes, I tell you, these cars, when they start like this, double file start, you really get wads early in cars, and it takes a while for straightening out and everything to get smooth. So everybody tries to be a little cautious, but they're coming off 3 deep and 4 deep and all that sort of stuff now.
That's part of the business, you know, that's just part of it. You have to, everybody's driver-wise, they know you just got to hold your breath there until you can kind of get sorted out and lined out. Then you really, the tires get a little heat in them, then you really find out what kind of spring and chassis combination you've got.
Hey, we may see a tire war in 1988 here at Winston Cup Racing.
Well, yes, I think we're already seeing one in the Grand National with Hoosier tires versus Goodyear. There's a rumor that General tire is coming in very strongly, too, and we'll just have to see what develops on that.
Well, there you see the interval between first and second. The car in the middle is the Rutland car, a lap down. It's Earnhardt first and Terry Labonte in second. Let's go to the STP Pit Control Center and Dave Despain standing by.
The big story of that last yellow flag was the problem for Morgan Shepherd, who'd been leading the race, fell all the way to the back end of the top 10, actually had to make 2 pit stops under the yellow flag. The problem was in the fueling system of the car. Here you see Morgan on pit road. They were trying to get the car properly fueled, but it did not fuel properly. As they changed the tires on the car, the fuel man there obviously looking a little concerned about the situation. Let's get more on that from Jerry Garrett.
Well, Dave, the culprit down here is this little item here, which got jammed up. When you push on this, the fuel comes out, it goes into the tank, and it would not open for anybody to work. Looks like it's going to wind up costing Morgan about a half a lap now before he can get sorted out of traffic and get caught back up to the front.
There's the leader, Earnhardt. Yellow and blue colors, soon to be the Goodwrench colors, silver and black. Lake Speed.
Yeah, we are. To realize too, though, that on the second stop they came back, and I think everything's squared away now. They use a different probe and filled it up, so I think Morgan's okay. He's just got a few cars he's gonna have to work his way through to get back into that number one slot.
Well, Morgan's run great all day, and I think when your car's that good, even though you get caught back, you're running as fast as leader. We have a problem here at the start finish line.
Car blowing an engine directly down below us, and into turn number 1 looks like McDuffie.
Didn't appear to put any oil down, so everybody should be safe. They may not even put a caution out. They don't appear to be oil.
While we watch McDuffie come in, let's talk again about the problems of these low buck independents for 88. We hear about more and more teams like Roush Racing, one of the super names in drag racing and in sports car racing. They're coming down to race in Winston Cup next year from up in Michigan, and more big teams. I really feel for these teams like McDuffie and Means and the Elmo Langley team. What are they going to do?
I really don't know how they're going to handle it. They have to hope that they can find someone to help them. People like Lake Speed will run the entire season next year for his sponsor, and there are several, 6 or 7 people going to do that.
Watch this battle for third now. There's Ricky Rudd on the outside, the number 15. Budmore car, and here comes that Millie, number 9, down on the inside. Elliott pressing, moving in. And here comes number 17, Walter, to the bottom of the racetrack. And they're 3 wide for the position. Unbelievable racing. Walter, outside. The caution is better here, and just backs out of it a little. Let's those 2 points go for it.
What we've got here, Ken, is this has been the, we just had our first chance for the guys to actually stop the cars under caution, change four tires, not just two, but change the entire stagger setup from one end to the other. They really had an opportunity the first time to get their cars truly dialed in.
Bobby Allison closed on pit road, but here's the story right now. This is for second place. For the moment, Elliott is there. Labonte is in third, and in fourth is Walter. That's number nine, Awesome Bill. And right now, Gordon Perkle and the boys are hoping that within 2.5 hours they can ring the old siren over at Dawsonville, Georgia. But a long way to go. Now look at Walter making his move, and that car maneuvers well on the bottom of the track at this point, Lynn.
Up here, you know, Darrell has won a lot of races down here, and he's made it look easy a lot of times, too. And these track conditions are very good for Darrell Walter, too. He's been known years and years to be Mr. Smooth. That's what it takes when the track conditions are poor.
Well, you got some real smoothies all grouped together out here with Bill Elliott in that group, and also in the category is Waltrip, and there's Ricky Rudd, who just gets on with the program.
Yeah, our top five cars right now are closer together on the racetrack than they've been since the race started. I think part of that is due to the fact they got to come in, make a four-tire change, and really get a chance to work on their cars for the first time today.
Bobby Allison, they're working on his car back behind the wall. We reported that he had come out of pit road. They're now back working behind the wall on his car. As you watch here, the battle that's a little further up in the field. There's the Allison car back there. Oh, that's unfortunate for a three-time winner of this race, Bobby Allison, rolling back in car number 22.
You know, one of the very interesting things right now that's going on is after the guys have made this change, this stop and been able to work on their cars, several of the fast cars are running at the low part of the track right now, where this is the first time they've done this all day today.
Forgive me, I think I was in error. I said that he was a three-time winner, Bobby Allison, two-time winner of this race. And here's Benny Parsons, still trying to win it, coming on here before this biggest crowd ever for the AC Delco 500. More in a moment. We're 134 laps deep of the 492 to be run, and the AC Delco 500, and nobody is sitting down. And let me give you an example of why. As you see, Earnhardt lead, and now Bill Elliott in second. Just two laps ago, 135 at lap 133. On the inside, that's Terry Labonte diving down, trying to get underneath Earnhardt and take the lead. He turned it all the way sideways and got it back.
That's what you call wrecking, but not hitting anything.
Number 11 has fallen back to the third spot, the Junior Johnson car. Junior Johnson has won this race more than anyone else as a car owner. 9 times he's gone to victory lane here.
Well, I saw Junior, he's down in front of us, and it upset him so bad that he took his arms off of the jack. I mean, this is tough stuff out here. Junior's got his emotions flying now. Way to go, Junior.
I tell you what, Terry's been doing a super good job all race long. He's been working his way to the front slowly, but it's steady, and he'll be right back up there again in just a lap or two.
Did he lose some tires on that, however? I mean, he really had the wind coming through the side window.
Most of the time, what'll happen is you overheat the tires there for a little bit. He may ride along here and take it easy for a little bit, let the temperature settle back down on the tires, and then come back at him again.
As we watch Bill Elliott closing in here on Dale Earnhardt, keep in mind that is your leader and your second place man in the Winston Cup point standing. And the man that we just saw very nearly take the leader out and get into the wall, Terry Labonte, is third in those point rankings. So really it's Elliott and Labonte who have something at stake here in terms of point standing. But there is a development on the Earnhardt situation. It may account for the fact that the people chasing him have in fact been able to catch up. On the last pit stop, the rear end on the number three car was leaking grease. They've sent people back over to the truck to get seals and various kinds of patching materials in the event that the problem should worsen. And in the meantime, they were a little closed-mouthed about the possibility that they might slow Earnhardt down. Fact is, Earnhardt has slowed down on the racetrack. That could be the reason.
And Earnhardt has never been successful here, David. He's tried and tried, and the best he's been able to come up with was back in 1979 in his first performance when he came home fifth in this race. Last year he was sixth, and some other finishes, some engine failures have just been out of the top 10. He really wants to win this race. He just likes to put his name on everything.
Yeah, and he's pretty much done that. He bought him a new bulldozer. He's got him a big thing that'll cut trees down. He bought him a Chevrolet dealership. I just bought a truck from him, and he charged me list plus 10. I'm not exactly sure if that's good or not, but if you want a deal, go up there and Dale Earnhardt Chevrolet.
Here's car number 9, Bill Elliott. That's a free announcement from John Hayes for the likes of Dale Earnhardt. Less plus 10.
No, list plus 10. I paid too much and thought I got a good deal.
Here's car number 9, Elliott, closing in on the new car dealer.
Jay, I got some land I need to sell you. Some beachfront stuff down there.
Ken Squire with Lake Speed and Johnny Hayes, and here comes that battle for first place. And there is more developing on the Earnhardt story. Let's go to Pat Patterson.
Kurt Jovanine's the crew chief on this car. Kurt, we had a report of some grease leaking out of the rear end. Is there anything to it or any problem at this point?
I think NASCAR did something about it, too. I think it was a little overflow out of gas. I have to repeat it there. We got it pretty full.
No major problem at this point.
Shouldn't be. We're still a little loose on setup, but we're working on that.
Okay, no leaking grease. They talked about leaking grease under the rear end. Okay, that's Kurt Shelverdine, Kim.
There is a major problem on car number 3. It's car number 9. Elliott's on the bottom of the racetrack going for the lead. The Thunderbird pulls down inside of the Chevrolet. It is that classic confrontation of Winston Cup NASCAR racing. On the inside, here comes Elliott. What did Ray Melton used to say? Belly to the ground? Out of the turn, here he is, bottom of the racetrack from turn 4 back to the line. And Earnhardt on the outside begins to show his muscle once again.
They said something about the championship groove, I believe. That's that Ray's famous word.
I don't know where the championship groove is here today. We talked about it being a one groove racetrack, but it's one groove for each car.
Absolutely. Anywhere you want it to be is where it is out there today. If you're leading, you're in the groove.
I love it. I tell you what, it's a roller coaster for this. Just watch these two cars right here and watch the different lines they take. And I'm not sure who's got the great idea, but fans, they're loving Bill Elliott, and half the fans are punching the Bill Elliott fans. It's a good deal here.
And it is a packed house. There's lots of room to move around, pick somebody to beat on today. It is the biggest crowd they've ever had here at Rockingham for this AC Delco 500. That's the backstretch, and usually it's maybe a half, a third full. There's not a seat over there today. They're all out to see this great race, and the season, as far as the championship is concerned, ended on lap 1 when Earnhardt rolled through to win that $550,000 prize. And there you see some of the ecstasy, the bliss being enjoyed watching their man Bill Elliott out in front.
Well, the fans love it. We love it. You know, we were sitting here yesterday and went absolutely crazy watching the race, and you really sitting here being a part of it. It's great.
John, I was under control all the time.
Yeah, you were hollering and screaming.
Here you see Earnhardt in the number 3 running in that second spot. Elliott beginning to pull away just a bit. He has now about a 25-car length advantage. Terry Labonte's in third. Darrell Waltrip is fourth. Ricky Rudd is fifth. Kyle Petty's in sixth. Morgan is seventh. It's Jeff Bodine in eighth. Alan Kulwicki is ninth. Joe Rutland is in tenth. Buddy Baker, 11th. Sterling Marlin, 12th. Cale Yarborough, 13th at this time. We've completed 146 of the 492 laps to be run in the $460,000 AC Delco 500.
We're back in North Carolina, Motor Speedway, live on WTBS. We've got the action, the excitement of a 500-mile battle here. Look who's moved up to the front. It's Big Red, Bill Elliott, country boy from Georgia, who's come a long, long way since he came here for his very first race. Oh, we got trouble on the racetrack. Jeff Bodine has spun. Four cars getting involved as the number 64 goes in as well. That is Curtis Markham with problems. And we've got the number 82 car involved, Mark Stahl, a three-way tango on the backstretch.
And I think what happened was the car number 5, or number 29, Cale Yarborough, looked like he might have lost a motor link. And he started to slow down.
He either lost a motor or got in the wall, one of the two.
Let's take a look at replay. I believe you'll see the orange and white car on the outside slowing dramatically. Baker comes to the inside, tags Jeff Bodine in the number 5. You see Bodine, the yellow, white, and brown car on the inside, now turning sideways and looping around, just missing the tail end of Cale's car. Now he lies dead on the track, Baker pulling through. Here comes the rest of the field, and here comes trouble. There's the 64 car sideways as he nails the back end of Bobby Wolak's machine, and all hell breaks loose here for a moment. That's Mark Stahl's number 82 in trouble.
I think that was Sterling Marlin that jumped down in there.
Yeah, it was Sterling that had to come low to avoid Cale, slow it up real fast, and he got into Jeff. Then the other car, the second series, the wrecks there, it appeared that the 64 car evidently didn't realize the car, the 75 car, whichever one was in front of him, was slowing up, and he tail-ended him.
And indeed, a blown engine on Cale is the story. It looked to me like Cale had really lost power. Car number 64, Curtis Markham, was that driver out of Richmond, Virginia, you know, the kid that's finished in second place in that Mid-Atlantic Series the last 2 years. He's a good driver. We saw him win one of those fortune races up at Richmond on that fairgrounds half mile last year. Fine driver,
and I think this is one of his first, he wants to get into Winston Cup, but I believe this is one of his first opportunities, and he and the Elmo Langley car had his hands full out there.
Well, when you come your first time, you get caught in these situations, and they don't have the natural reflexes or confidence that a late speed would or some of the older pros, and those are things you go through, and you know you're going to deal with that when you bring a young driver in.
I think one of the biggest things that happens to guys is they get caught up, and it's all new. It's a new car, it's new surroundings, it's new everything, and they wind up trying to look at everything. And sometimes they don't look far enough down the track to see something developing early. Now, Pat Patterson in the pits has got a story for us.
Well, the leader, Dale Earnhardt, was in. It was a four-tire change for Earnhardt. However, we didn't see them work at all on the rear end. Now, we have word that they have sent somebody back to the truck to check into some parts for the rear end, and we may see that change as we go on further this afternoon. Gentlemen?
Thank you, Pat. There is a story on Bodine's car as it comes rolling out, and he's taken some sheet metal damage. On the other side, left side of the car, he doesn't quite so well here.
Well, the right side of the car really looks good. Hopefully, it didn't get the front end knocked out of the line or anything. Maybe just four new tires, and he'll get back and proceed as he was.
Hopefully, we can look at that one more time at that incident in turn number two, which is the first major incident of the day. That has involved five or six cars. It is the typical thing to Rockingham, but we anticipated we would see a lot more of. This happened at lap 153, or two laps into the caution at 155. And let's take another look at it. And there you see Cale up on the outside. He looked like he was losing power about 200 feet before there. And indeed, that's Sterling Marlin down in the middle. On the bottom is Bodine. Bodine tries to make a great save there.
Well, I believe they just caught in a situation. Cale slowed quickly. Sterling had to go under, and I think he was going under just at the time. Jeff was trying to get by Sterling, and there just wasn't room for the three of them.
And there you see Curtis Markham, the Old Dominion Speedway champion, Southside Speedway champion up in Virginia this past year, getting in trouble. He hit the binders, and then it all breaks loose. Oh, that's a bad break for Mark Stahl, California driver.
That's what happens on these things. So it's just very rarely that on a wreck only one person gets taken out.
Front end knocked out on car number five.
They're doing a check.
We'll be back with more here from the AC Delco 500 live on the Superstation after these words. Working the 158th lap, prepared for a green flag to put the field back into action in our live coverage of the AC Delco 500 here on the Superstation, WTBS, as they come to green. Terry Labonte is in first, Dale Earnhardt second, Bill Elliott third, Ricky Rudd is fourth, Morgan Shepherd fifth, Kyle Petty sixth, Darrell Waltrip seventh, Alan Kowicki is in eighth, Jeff Bodine is ninth, Bobby Hill in tenth, Buddy Baker 11th, Joe Ruttman 12th. They come down to take the flag from Harold Kinder with the 13th position belonging to Phil Parsons, 14th, Harry Gant. In the turn number one, Terry Labonte is there. In that second spot, it is Earnhardt pulling up on him. Here topside of the start-finish line, Lake Speed with me. And also alongside this afternoon, Johnny Hayes. And down in the pits, we can get a story on that Bodine car right now. Let's go to Jerry Garrett first for this update.
Johnny with Cale Yarbrough. What happened in that incident, Cale? Something left go in the engine. I don't know exactly what it was, but, you know, this hard-eased car was running pretty good, and I felt good about the way things were going. But that's the way it goes. It's been a tough year.
Altogether tough year. What ahead for the rest of the year now?
Well, I'm going to run myself. I'll run Atlanta then the next month, and that'll be my last one this year. I sure need a win bad.
Yeah, we're hoping for good luck for the next race. Let's go down pit road to Pat Patterson, an update on Bodine's car.
Well, the five car was in, Jerry, and they went under the hood to check the tie rod or the lower control arm on the right side. They checked both the toe end on both sides, and apparently the handling on the car is off. We'll wait and see what happens when they bring the car back in. It was a long stop. They came in three times in that car. Kent?
And he is down some here, running by himself. Meanwhile, up in front, you saw the move by Earnhardt as he went around Terry Labonte to take the lead. There you see Buddy Baker's car also in the action. He's in 10th, a lap down, Carnival 88.
Notice that the line that everybody's taking again now, the fresh tires, ideal conditions, they went back to the same lower groove that you'd use for qualifying. Now watch and see whose car goes to the top of the track first. Will give you some indication of whose combination is really closer to being correct.
Well, Dale Earnhardt is staying low right in the middle, and I think these tires will probably hold them for about 10 laps, and I think you'll see everybody go back up to the wall again and just let the car run free so that we keep those RPMs and get those shots off the corner.
We watch Dale Earnhardt in that blue and white number three, those familiar colors. Gary Labonte in the number 11 is right there beating at the door. We watched Earnhardt go by him there as Cale Yarborough was talking, but Labonte's got a big advantage in his corner here as he does battle with the lap car. Buddy Baker, look at Buddy come to life. Right around Terry Labonte. That is not a position battle. Labonte is second on the racetrack. Terry is driving for Junior Johnson. Junior Johnson has won more races as a car owner on this racetrack than anybody else. 13 in all. Eight of them have come in this the fall event. Labonte won one of those, and the crew chief on the car, Tim Brewer, is a seven-time winner here. Experience counts for a whole lot. Don't count Terry Labonte out of this thing.
Terry Labonte, very much a major figure here, the 83 winner, and Baker, as you saw himself move around one car, now being shown in 10th position, trying to get a lap back. You guys were talking about who had the handle and who did not. Looks like he found it, and it's really working for him.
Well, you get a tire change, and that helps. And here we're on Bill Elliott and Ricky Rudd,
third and fourth.
And both of those are fours, and they're running so competitive with each other. And I think Bill, because of a pit stop that didn't get him out quite as quick, will work his way to the front.
But look at Labonte being challenged now by those fours. Terry Labonte in the second spot. Junior Johnson, number 11, and here comes Elliott in third, and then back there in fourth is Rudd, and Morgan Shepherd is again gathering back ground as he continues to challenge with his Buick automobile. Just a fantastic race today here on the Superstation as we watch Terry Labonte by just about four car lengths at 155, 60 miles an hour on this one-mile track down into turn number three, up to the outside, a little moves, Elliott.
Right now, it's kind of like, to me, as a race car driver, this point in the race now, you've been running, you're not quite halfway in a long, long, grueling race, but right now, the cream is sort of coming to the top. The guys' chassis setup is really right. Those guys are starting to really run. It's a shame for Buddy Baker that he had to get a lap down. They didn't guess right on the original start, so they got a lap. But it's obvious right now, his car is as fast as anybody's on the racetrack.
Sure, he's right up there behind Earnhardt. Looks like he wants to go by him.
And again, this is someone else. Earnhardt does not like to intimidate, right? Buddy Baker is a man's man, and you have to meet him anywhere. And Buddy is getting ready to bow and lap himself, and he'll do it with pleasure.
Well, not only that, you got to remember that Buddy's also announced next year is going to be his last year, he said, as a driver. He's going to retire, and he would love nothing more than to get on the winner's circle at the end of this year so he could ride the championship all the way through next year.
As Earnhardt fades higher and higher in the corners, Baker's trying to take that lap back. Look at car number three, Earnhardt, right here. Getting very physical with car number three. We asked Dale if he thought this would be a physical race.
I hope it's a clean race. Everybody races hard here, but I think the racetrack will be one of the races. It's just like Darlington. You can get in trouble easy, and if you forget where you're racing at, forget what you're doing, you can get in trouble and you let the racetrack bite you. I think we're trying to look ahead, pay attention to what's going on out there, watching the cars around you, just keep you out of trouble.
While that Danny Schiff car, number 88, driven by Buddy Baker, pulls up to get the lap back, but Earnhardt, relentless. Doesn't care if you live next door. If it's his grandmother, he'll put him a lap down.
Well, I think you see how he gets to jump off that turn. You know, Buddy will be by him, and he'll get the shot off the turn and work back by him again. But Earnhardt will race you all day, door to door. He loves that.
Well, look behind him. Look at that battle developing behind him. Terry Labonte and Elliott are side by side for second place, and it is Elliott on the inside, but here comes Labonte back. What a battle this one is.
One of the things we ought to note here, Ken, you look for patterns in a race like this, and one that we have noted from here in the Pitt Communications Center is that those two red Fords in this lead quintet of cars get good when there's a pit stop. They come back out of the pits loaded for bear. Elliott's number nine, Rudd right behind him in the 15 car, on the previous long yellow, came out and ran right up to the front. Then as the green flag racing wears on, they seem to go away a little bit, and then once they get a stop, they come right back. Elliott is going after the lead once again, and Rudd's coming right with him. Quick note about Buddy Baker as he unlaps himself. Number one, a yellow puts him right back into the hunt now with what is obviously one of the fastest cars on the racetrack. Two, Buddy is is riding the longest losing streak of his career. Three, he is one of eight non-winners here, previous winners who has not won a race yet this year.
And we have a four-car shuffle for the lead. Look at Elliott closing in again on the blue and yellow car, Bernhardt on the outside. Look at Labonte in the 11. And Rudd is right there, all four pressing, and Baker has made up that lap and is trying to draw away on the bottom of the racetrack. Bill Elliott flies.
Well, the other competitors love it when the leaders run door-to-door like this. It slows the pace down. It gives you a chance to catch up and buys you more time. So the pace does slow down when you run side-by-side.
Buddy Baker can't do anything to be tickled to death with the fact that those guys back there are racing their hearts out. He doesn't wish any bad luck on anybody, but he sure does wish it'd be a caution right now.
Let's see. There you see the interval between the 88 back to the number three car as Baker has made up his lap. And Buddy Baker, who's waited a long time to see an opportunity at victory, is trying to draw around, wait for caution. Look at Elliott in number nine going for the lead. Remember that Baker, running back in 10th position, is the last car in the lead lap.
Also, the Oldsmobile group as a whole, with me being one of the drivers there too, Oldsmobile needs to win real bad. And they are really, really pushing it pumped up. Buddy's running that thing hard to the good.
Morgan Shepherd's Buick is up there in 5th position. Kyle Petty's Ford is in 6th. Meanwhile, up in front, Elliott again is fighting his way through and losing it another time. It looked like he had Earnhardt, had him right by the throat. And Earnhardt just pulled away.
Buddy Baker continues to run right in front of everyone. They're not closing on him at all. And that just shows you he finally hit that setup, the tire combination, the stagger. He's into car number 88.
Last four laps, four lead changes out here just behind Baker in the 88. Wouldn't it be grand to see him get it back together?
But
last five laps, he's had five lead changes.
But he's had some great runs this year. He really has. He's one of those people, like Lake Speed, like so many others, that have fallen victim to circumstances. But there's a lot of good cars that have had good years that are all disappointed in their season, and everybody's about ready to get it over and get ready for next year.
The name of the game is win the race.
The major circumstance is that car number three that's won 11 races this year, Earnhardt. Six laps, six lead changes as they go back and forth every lap. This is just remarkable. It's a Ford-Chevy battle, the number nine of Elliott, as the war continues out there.
Believe me, this is great for the race fans, but it's not good for Bill Elliott to be sitting there running on the inside of the low groove side by side. He is punishing his tires, and it could wind up hurting him later. If they run for a long green span here, he's apt to hurt from it.
Well, another important thing here, these fans are about equally split on pulling for Elliott and Earnhardt. Everybody in the place is standing up on pit road, grandstands, everywhere watching this. And it's a little victory every time one gets by the other, so they're not going to lift, and here comes Elliott again.
Well, it's a big crowd, and nobody's getting a chance to do anything but jump and ramble out here today.
I guarantee you that Ricky Rudd is sitting there saying, you guys keep duking it out so I can get y'all. Y'all burn your tires up, me and Terry will drive by both of you and see you later.
Now you see Elliott is back in front again as they swap it back and forth. An interesting thing we might want to see here is the interval not among these front four. You can see all them together, but where is Morgan Shepherd in this? There you see the front four. Now where's Morgan Shepherd? There he is in the green car, the Buick, and Morgan Shepherd is more and more a factor in this race. Behind him in sixth is Kyle Petty.
Well, you can see how the race has changed. Lake pointed out everybody needed a chance to dial their cars in. Well, now they have, and Earnhardt does not have that awesome advantage he had early.
Trouble. We've got trouble up here at turn number one and into two with Earnhardt getting around it. And there is a caution on the track. This will be the fourth caution of the day.
The most important thing that happened here, no offense to the guy that spun, but Buddy Baker just got his lap back. So we're going to have even more cars up there going for this lead.
10 cars battling for the lead in this remarkable race taking place here on the Superstation Live. Let's take a look again at what happened in turn number one. There's the looper that has brought out the caution. It's car number 51 skittering down to the bottom of the racetrack and calling it an afternoon. That would be the, I think, Simcoe car. Is it David Simcoe's car? Now we're in with Benny Parsons once again, who stays up there in that top 15 in the Folgers car with our Superflow Motor Oil's in-car camera walking along through the day. Caution, fourth time of the afternoon as Benny Parsons pulls on pit road. That's where the activity is. We'll be back for more of it shortly.
the largest cities in North Carolina on this Sunday afternoon. North Carolina Motor Speedway in Rockingham here in the STC Pitt Communications Center. A shuffle among the key players. Who's going to fill that fourth slot? Probably Morgan Shepherd when they come back out. Earnhardt, Labonte, Elliott, Shepherd, Rudd, and Buddy Baker all in for Pitt during this yellow flag period, this caution that will unscramble it. And the big factor, of course, is Buddy Baker, who has unlapped himself. Let's get more on the Pitt Road story from Pat Fitzpatterson.
Well, Doug Richards, the crew chief on the car. You guys are pretty happy. You got it back in the lead lap.
Yes, we are. At that one point, we was two laps down, and we managed to get four tires on the car after a tire equalized on us, and the car is running real well. We made up that one lap under the green conditions, and then we just made up that one there. This Baker Schiff Olds is really doing a good job for us so far. If we can just keep up the good luck and hopefully redeem ourselves from that pit crew competition we had yesterday. And I think you can see by the crew's job today that they're doing a good job.
Okay, let's go back upstairs. Thank you, Doug.
Thank you, Pat. As we go back to green, Baker, best finish here, 71 and 73, both times second in 71 to Richard Petty, and in 73 to David Pearson, who beat him by a couple of laps. So we'll follow his exploits here this afternoon as we're back to the racing. And as they get into the back straightaway, and under green, what a time he has completed 186 laps. Out in front is Earnhardt. Second position is Terry Labonte. Third is Elliott. Fourth, Walker. Fifth, Rudd. Sixth, Shepherd. Seventh, Petty. Kyle. Eighth, Bodine. Jeff. Ninth, Buddy Baker. Tenth, Rutman. As we're back under green.
Mr. Rutman doesn't want to be a lap down very long either. He's pretty aggressive here.
Well, I think one thing is Earnhardt's lost his dominance a little bit, and it gives cars a chance, if they hit that right combination, to get a lap back. So everybody's hustling now.
Well, let's see if they've Kurt Schelmerding found it for them here. Lots of interest about the Earnhardt team because they've been so successful winning the title for 2 years. Great deal of pressure on that team. As a lot of other owners, a lot of other team managers are trying to buy off some of the people from that Earnhardt organization. Must be tough to keep a team together when you're a champion like that, John.
I'm not sure it's that tough because they all love each other so much. I think that's about 80% of the magic, the Dale Earnhardt team. Those people, if you fight one of them, you got to fight all of them. They're super people. They work hard. They got a great blend. But the whole key is Richard Childress is one of the class acts in NASCAR racing.
Well, there's a class act, too, at number 88, Buddy Baker. How slippery is this track as you run in ninth compared with other years, Buddy?
A lot worse than I've seen it in quite a while. Especially getting off the number two corner. It's extremely hazardous over there. So everybody knows it. I hope I don't get there like in Charlotte. You know, I went in the number one corner in Charlotte, and there were four or five cars that had already wrecked and started spinning back up the racetrack. And several of cars were caught in a situation where you had nowhere to go. But Rockingham's extremely bad about that because it's such a narrow racetrack. When you come off like two, if a bunch of cars are wrecking over there, there's nowhere to avoid the wreck.
Baker in ninth, going around Ken Schrader another time. Let's go back up front. There's the battle for the lead. Terry Labonte, 83 winner of this event, goes to the bottom under Dale Earnhardt. And apparently haven't been able to remedy whatever the malady was in car number three as he shuffles to the outside. Terry Labonte digs down low, deep. And boy, what a heart and what determination on that guy. He was going for it that time.
Well, yeah, and I think, again, he hit that combination. And Junior was so excited, he put his foot back on top of the jack. He's on the edge down there.
I guarantee you that car shot right off that second corner. But Buddy was just talking about how slippery it was, but it looked like Terry really had a good hold over there.
Front two automobiles now trying to draw away by about 30 car lengths from Bill Elliott, maintaining third position with fourth Walter. There you see that interval. And there's Walter back and forth, just in the bottom of your picture for a moment, back to the 2 liters. Lake,
you know, Darrell has kind of slipped up through there. I noticed, too. He's been running right well. So he could be a factor before this thing's out, too. He knows how to win this racetrack.
Fifth Rudd, sixth Shepherd, fifth Petty. Here's Pat Patterson.
Well, Kurt Schelmerdine's here, the crew chief on the car. Kurt, the car is the car obviously is not working as well as it was. Do you know what's causing it?
It really hadn't been working well the whole day.
Is the rear end a real problem at this point?
Well, the car's pretty sideways. That's the way we've been really all week. We haven't got it quite as good as we think it should be yet. Maybe we can before the race is over.
Okay, that's the story, Ken.
So the story doesn't sound too good for Dale Earnhardt right now, Lee.
Well, the loose condition that they're describing also coincides with the fact that he's running high, real high on the racetrack. You take a less sharp corner, the loose race cars tend to go up. And Dale, as we've watched this day, he's been the first one to go up about every time.
Well, that's a classic example of having such a terrible race car, and it's been bad all day, and you're running second about five car lengths. That just tells you how good those people are. They're totally disappointed. The car's no good, and they're about five car lengths back from the leader.
Yeah. That's what you call him.
Yeah.
They may be in third very shortly as Elliott has intentions and closes in. Bill Elliott is on the move. Will he win again today? Here's Jerry Garrett with something more.
Well, down here on pit road, we have information about a couple of cars that have been in the top 10 all day. One is Alan Kulwicki, who we mentioned earlier is running up there in the top five. He had no brakes. He just came into the garage for three or four laps. He's got the brakes fixed. He's back down there, but he's way down out of contention now. The other one with brake problems is Kyle Petty. Now, he's running right up there. He just passed Morgan Shepherd. So, bear watching what may be the problem with Kyle Petty's brakes as well.
Indeed, we will. And there you see Alan Kulwicki in the number seven. This independent, former champion, the American Speed Association, the ASA, who moved up into Winston Cup racing, and I think is one of the most remarkable stories of the year. One car, he says he only raced one car at a time, so it doesn't bother him, but he only has one car and a couple of engines. Keeps a lot. Car spinning the main straightaway all around Simcoe. Down here in the area of turn four, just past the entrance to pit road.
He is really having a difficult time today. That car must be a handful.
Caution is out.
Fifth one of the day. 209 laps complete. Take that back. That may be 200 laps complete. Well, here's another gander at what happened to car number 51. Looks like he's coming down from... I'm not sure. He's on the apron.
Well, yeah, I think he was... He had a problem with the front end of his car, and I think he'd gotten off the pace to just come in and hit the brakes, and she just went around him.
So we're under caution once again, and as they do, we'll see if any of the leaders come in. We'll be back with more of the action from the HD Delco 500 in Rockingham after these messages. Well, they've just been on pit road, so the jack isn't there, but there's the man, Junior Johnson, whose teams have won this race nine times.
Well, Junior's... everybody's hero on pit road. He's a legend. He was a great racer. He's a great car owner. But you can tell the excitement. Now he's looking for birds because birds could interfere with this thing. He's got both hands in his coat pocket. He's got his leg on the upper wall. I think you can see Terry Labonte go for it this time because Junior is uptight.
As uptight as you ever see him.
Oh, God.
Unless he's got something to say to a NASCAR official.
We should make him president of the United States. I don't think anybody'd intimidate him.
I'll tell you, some other interesting things happened on the pit stop just then. Kyle Petty and Darrell Walter, for example, felt so good with their cars that they did not make a four-tire change then. Our leader and a couple of the other cars that were leading the race prior to it came in and changed four tires. Obviously, they must feel like if they had a good setup when they were in then.
Okay, Lake, well, what do you want to run here? Do you want to run the stickers, or do you want to run some tires that had a little miles in?
Prior to the race starting, based on practice times yesterday, everybody was wanting to run sticker tires. They felt like that was going to be the fastest thing to do, a new tire. But as the race changes and the weather changes outside, things can happen. There may be experiment. This could be an experiment with these two teams saying, look, we need to see a discusser better or what these sticker tires we've been putting on are different. So we'll try the discuss.
Ready for restart. Coming down out of the turn. 203 laps complete of 492. In front, Kyle Petty, Darrell Walter second, Buddy Baker third. Terry Labonte fourth, Earnhardt fifth, Elliott sixth, Shepherd seventh, Rudd eighth, Bodine ninth, Rutland tenth, and away they go.
Can you imagine those guys that when they come around this corner this time, they're going to look down at the end of the straightaway, look on the board, and they're going to see that they're not even halfway yet.
They've been sitting there delving this thing and beating their brains out, getting jostled around for a couple hours. How do you feel at halfway?
You don't want to look up at that board. You just keep going and keep working because you know they'll tell you when it's over.
Kyle Petty in front. Another new leader in this race. We've had 20 lead changes, now 21 among seven drivers. Just Kyle Petty effort up in front. And there you see Darrell Waltrip in the second place. Back straightaway. Kyle leading. Winner of the Coca-Cola 600 at Charlotte, North Carolina, this past May. Now here comes to the inside Darrell Waltrip trying to make a move, and he does not get through. We asked Darrell about his luck turning for the better at this time of the year.
I got my little daughter born, and she's healthy and fine, and my wife's fine, and that took the weight of the world off my shoulders. Forget all this other about the race team, Waddell, me, whatever you want to blame it on. But when that all got taken care of, I'm back working on my driving, working on my racing, and I think I'm about to get it conquered again.
He's conquered it right now. He's back in front. Walter in the lead. In second place, Kyle Petty. Terry Labonte moving up into third. Buddy Baker coming along, and Dale Earnhardt into fourth. Baker falling to fifth now. Labonte to third, Earnhardt to fourth. Baker falls to fifth.
This is a great thing I love about Winston Cup racing. It changes. It's the little things that make the difference between who's running up front and who's not nowadays. It's not something major. They come in, and something as little as a stagger difference on the tires makes a guy that's been running average, like, you know, Darrell and Kyle weren't setting the world on fire, but they weren't running bad. They were just sort of running back there behind the guys that have been dicing for it. After tire changes, here they are leading the race.
Jerry Garrett, how about Kyle Petty right now?
Well, we understand down here after talking to Leonard Wood that there is no more problem with the brakes. There's no problem at all with the car. That's why they didn't even bother to change tires last time. It's like the good old days. The Wood brothers running up front again here at Rockingham.
That's good news for Kyle Petty and for the Wood brothers. Meanwhile, up in front, here's that battle. You're watching Kyle Petty in second being challenged by Terry Labonte. Labonte going to the inside. Almost touching in turn three. Kyle fades high. Give it to Terry Labonte. Second place. Waltrip up in front. Terry Labonte in second. Kyle Petty in third. And here comes Earnhardt. Dale Earnhardt, bottom of the racetrack. He's ready to go for it again.
Well, Dale, you know, his car's been bad all day. They can't get it to work. But for some reason, he keeps going to the front. You think Kurt's being honest with us?
I think he might be stretching the truth a little.
Sound like a Johnny Hayes story to me.
Car number 17, Waltrip stays first. Here comes Terry Labonte, closing on the leader. Down to the bottom of the racetrack in turn four. Exciting action today here on the Superstation. Three cars locked together into the first turn. On the outside, car number 11, Labonte makes his move. And all the way to the very top of the track, it's Earnhardt in the number three.
How about that? Three wide. What else you want?
Back straightaway. Terry Labonte, Texas Terry, back in front. And here comes Earnhardt. Waltrip down on the bottom. Incredible action. And for the moment, you have Chevrolet 1-2-3. Force early in the afternoon showing their colors. And now the Chevy's up in front. And don't forget that Morgan Shepherd is still very much a figure in this race. He's being shown in seventh place. And we're less than half the distance. Back straightaway, car number 11, the 1983 champion of this event, driving for the man who has won this race nine times as a car owner. Junior Johnson is in first. I wonder how excited Junior is right now down there. Dale Earnhardt is in that second spot. Waltrip in third, Elliott in fourth, Kyle Petty in fifth. There's some excitement over here on this side of the fence, that's for sure.
Junior is so excited, he's moved up into the pit wall entrance and is standing on both feet. This is it. He loves to watch his team up front.
22 lead changes among nine drivers and still only half the distance, and nobody has had any kind of breathing room if they have accepted first place in this race.
Well, the great thing about it today, I think Darrell Waltrip is a perfect example. He ran up front, he let a few cars by, but Darrell Waltrip is one of the most intelligent drivers we have, and he knows we have a ways to go, and he's going to take care of that race car and not burn it up or burn his tires up racing these people. And I think that's key, don't you?
Absolutely. An event that has this distance in it, this grind. Once you know your car can do it, then you've got the confidence in it. Then you can sort of cruise just a little bit, but only a little bit.
Front four come across, and Baker has scooted. Well, Baker is about to be challenged. Baker is going to feel the wrath of Kyle Petty here in a moment. Number 21 is definitely moving in. And here we have the in-car camera shot from Benny Parsons.
with the Superflow motor oils in-car camera.
Well, the in-car camera has been probably the greatest invention for our sport, so the fan can get a real feeling how fast we're going, how close we are. And I think of anything that's made racing on TV to give a fan a feeling at home what it is, I really believe it's that in-car camera. And I'd like to thank people like Superflow for contributing this to the sport.
It's taken it from the business of being a reality sport, because we all drive cars, into the fantasy sport that it truly is. But you're sitting here with a driver, and you see that grandstand flashing by, and you realize that if you turn that wheel an extra eighth of an inch, you're done for the season, not just through the turn. It gives you a whole new idea about what this game is about.
And it lets you know how close you are to the wall. Look at that. It's awesome. When you stand here and they go by so fast, you know. But if you're at home, they don't look like they're going that fast. You don't have the sound. But I assure you, it will take your breath.
As we look at it now, the Parsons car is running back in, as we have it, I think, 16th position, 17th position. Ken Schrader was 21 points behind Bobby Allison coming into today's AC Delco 500. And it looks like Schrader has a chance to do some real moving in the points, as Bobby Allison was one of the very first cars to have some problems here today. That was a tough break for Bobby. Car number 22 early on.
The sun's popped out a little bit. It's getting a little warmer, and it certainly can change your racetrack.
Also, the windshields, I'm going to tell you, they get pitted, they get a little oil on them. When you start going off down this first turn down here, it'll be a little bit worse in about three-quarters of the way through the race, but it'll get to where you are absolutely driving off in that first turn totally blind.
It's just part of it. Count to eight and turn left. Here's the leader, Terry Labonte, in car number 11. Bill Elliott closing in another time. This Ford Chevrolet confrontation taking place in the AC Delco 500 at Rockingham, North Carolina. And Dale Earnhardt now rides third. More of the exciting action of this great afternoon. Look at this. Here is Elliott back to the inside, taking another stab at the front position. He has Labonte on the outside. Kenny dispatches. Pulls alongside. Gets the nose down. And Bill Elliott of Dawsonville, Georgia, going for the lead. Within, he brings Dale Earnhardt up to contend for second position. It's just incredible racing here today. On the Superstation, our next telecast will be from Riverside, California. We'll be with you there on Sunday, November 8th, on that 9-turn road course in California. We hope you fans will enjoy that event. And, of course, the last race of the season is November 22nd in Atlanta. Here are those top three cars, and Earnhardt seems to settle back into that third spot for the moment. Wait them out just a bit. We'll be back with more of the action here very shortly. 23 lead changes among nine drivers tells you this is some great race.
Promotional fee and consideration paid by STP. For nearly three decades, America has been driving and winning with STP.
STP is the racer's edge.
And by Busch Beer, the beer with a taste as smooth as its name. And by True Value.
In October, get Philips Longer Life Soft White Bulbs and earn a $1 rebate when you buy two four-packs for just $3.66 at participating True Value hardware stores.
228 laps have now been complete. Dale Earnhardt is maintaining third spot behind the leader, Bill Elliott, in number 9, and that number 11 car right there of Terry Labonte. Interesting speculation, gentlemen. This is Ken Squire topside with Johnny Hayes and with Lake Speed. Number 3 hasn't been running as well when it was overcast, but now that the sun is out, he seems to come back. And that car always seems to run like a scalded cat when it gets a little warm outside, John.
Well, we've seen that happen many times at Charlotte a few years back. Beanie Parsons almost lapped the field on a cloudy day, and Bill Elliott was just running average. The sun came out, Bill Elliott did lap the field, and Beanie Parsons finished a distant second. So weather does change everything.
How about it, Lake?
Well, it does in the majority of the cases. Sometimes the track conditions will kind of equal out. Here today, we'll just have to watch and see if it's going to do it. The guys had already complained about the track being slick. So, normally the sun will come out and make the track even slicker. We'll just have to wait and see what the deal is here.
230 laps down. Let's go to a GM Goodwrench update. Standing by is Bob Richards with Motorsports News.
Thanks,
10, the World of Outlaws are on a Western swing this weekend. Last night, Steve Kinzer continued his domination of the course, winning the 21st annual Pacific Coast Nationals at Ascot Park in California. Kinzer has now won 23 of the last 25 events. Well, here at Rockingham yesterday, the AC Delco 200 for Grand National cars was held. What a finish in this one. Last lap, last turn, Jeff Bodine in the yellow number 15 in front. Morgan Shepherd trying to take him on the high side. They go to the finish line door to door. Now, who won? Well, both drivers thought they won. They both headed for victory lane. After checking the video, NASCAR officials say Shepherd is the winner. The margin of victory, 6 inches. Can't ask for any better than that. Well, that's it for this GM Goodwrench update. Let's go back upstairs to Kenworth.
Thanks again, Bob. We're now showing 232 laps complete, moving toward the halfway point at lap 246. And again, Elliott first, Labonte second, Dale Earnhardt third, Morgan Shepherd a stout fourth, Darrell Walker fifth, Buddy Baker is sixth, Kyle is seventh, Jeff Bodine is eighth, Ricky Rudd is ninth, Harry Gant 10th, Phil Parsons 11th, Joe Rutman 12th, Rusty Wallace in 13th, Richard Petty in 14th, Sterling Marlin 15th, and Ken Schrader is running 16th. Now, we talked about Schrader earlier. He is running in a point battle for 10th spot. He was in 11th in the Winston Cup points coming into today's race. He had 3,145 points. Bobby Allison, 3,166. Allison quickly out of the race, and 31st place finish or better. Schrader moves into 10th. What's that worth to a guy at the end of the year, gentlemen?
Well, not only is it an additional payoff in the NASCAR banquet in New York, but there's another thing that's a little subtle difference, too. When we pick pits, the national champion gets the first pick. Then the next top 10 guys and points get their pick. Then it goes to the qualifiers. So it's also worth something in the next two races strategy-wise.
Well, the other thing with a person like Kenny Schrader, from a prestige standpoint, he's a young race car driver. He's driving car number 90 there. And I'm telling you, it will mean the world to him that he's one of the 10 best drivers in his sport, because we've just said there's 30 good race teams out here. And for a young man, it shows he's taking a big step forward.
And believe me, it's nice to step up on the stage in New York and run at the banquet.
Car number 71, right behind him is another great driver, Dave Marcus. I'd like to see him have a great day here again soon. He was a real rip snorter a few years ago. There he is, car number 71, out of Wisconsin, Wausau, Wisconsin. And he's had his share of problems, but they seem to be coming a little stronger here in the last couple of months for the Dave Marcus team. Now, as we get back to the front of the field, Dave Marcus is number 71. Is being shown as in the 17th position at this time. Here's Bill Elliott in number 9, your leader.
I don't know if it's weather or what, but I'll tell you what, right now the combination Bill's got, he's drawing away from the field.
Let's check the interval between first and second place. The interval between the number 9 car and the number 11 car, and see how much the interval is between those two. There's the 11 car, Terry Labonte, in that second spot as they wheel the line, and here is back from Elliott. It's about 3 6/10 seconds, gentlemen. So Elliott is beginning to show that same old Elliott strength. And again, it's PIV, patience is a virtue. Elliott is a great example of that. He waits it out, and then when it's time, he begins to make his drive. But it's still far early.
Well, yeah, but I tell you, Bill likes to get out there because he's running in front pretty much by himself, uncontested. He does not enjoy racing Earnhardt door-to-door, I don't think.
And who does?
Well, I'd say Morgan Shepherd would love to be up there beside him. And there are a few that are pit bulls also, and you have to have them chained at night, but yes.
Well, that depends on what you pay for your own stuff.
Another car that's really coming on is number 55. That's Phil Parsons, who's up to 11th place. That's the team that John Hayes used to own. Got a lot better after you left, John.
Well, that's sort of my life story. I've brought a lot of companies to their knees. That's why I've held 15 jobs in my career. But I keep trying, and I promise you I will try to get out of this business quick so Mr. Turner can keep going.
Here's car number 75 up on the outside. And trying to make his move is Joe Rutman. Rutman, who is falling way back in the pace and is being shown down in 12, fighting with Phil Parsons in the 55 and 11. And take that high line for Joe Rutman from Upland, California. His brother, Troy Rutman, former winner of Indianapolis back in 53. Joe, I think he's got a year coming where he's going to win some races. He's a fine racer.
my understanding that Joe Ruttman is in the process of trying to put his own race team together for next year. There's been no official announcements, but one thing that's really graphic with these two cars is the different lines they're taking. Joe Ruttman's going very high. He shoots up the racetrack, close to the wall. Phil Parsons is low, and again, they're running almost exactly the same. Phil pulled away a little bit.
And notice that right in front of them is that car of Kyle Petty. Kyle Petty, and I think there may be a lap interval on those cars. You see Kyle Petty's car there, and there's Bill closing in once again. Let's go back to the leader, Bill Elliott. Here you see him in the number 9, closing in on Ken Schrader's number 90. They cross the line. Bill Elliott out in front. We asked Bill, how does he remain so patient the entire race to be on that lead lap and take it home at the finish?
Well, I think one thing, you got to have patience anywhere you go, but still you got to be able to run good enough, stay in the lead lap, to have that chance at the end of the day. And that's the biggest key to this type of race.
And, of course, he has brought home a few winners this year. Only Dale Earnhardt has won more. Elliott has taken the checkered flag 4 times, including his last outing in Charlotte, North Carolina, 2 weeks ago.
You know, nobody's ever won a race sitting in the garage with a wrecked car. And I think, you know, that strategy, people may say you got to go run wide open, wide open, wide open all day long. Well, it won't do you any good if you run the thing and wreck it. You know, you got to use good common sense as to what your car is capable of doing. I'm not trying to ask it to do more than it will do.
We have a race summary coming up for you, and across the bottom of the screen, here are the runners as they are in the field. We'll take you back through them, and you racing fans at home that enjoy the competition can check in on the guys that you like and admire a little further back in competition. As of 200 laps, this is how they were running. We have 9 cars remaining in the lead lap. And beyond that, we have another 8 cars, 1 lap down. They're averaging 118 miles per hour today here in this race. Ronnie Thomas is still out there. You see Trevor Boyce. And Dave Marcus being listed in the 27th spot. We're talking about him just a few moments ago. Race is stabilized for the moment. And running out in front is Bill Elliott. This race always has a period of this kind of setup toward the finish. But the last 3 years, this race has been decided at the finish line. You'd think 500 miles in a mile track in the old days, you think of, boy, a close race is somebody winning by 2 laps, someone by 4 or 5 laps. Doesn't happen anymore.
Well, I think it'll be settled again very closely the same way, because a few laps back, you could have thrown a blanket over the first 3 cars. Bill Elliott is pulling away a little bit, but we don't know exactly. This isn't a shootout yet, so let's go.
Getting down to halfway. Halfway this time by here today as Bill Elliott continues to lead in the AC Delco 500.
Hey, the folks are getting their money's worth here on this sometimes cloudy, sometimes sunny Sunday afternoon in Rockingham, North Carolina. The guy they're watching charge is Bill Elliott. Early in the race, when Dale Earnhardt was so dominant, on my stopwatch, the biggest lead he had was 6.71 seconds. Just before we came back, Bill Elliott's lead was 6.71 seconds. He's piling up True Value hard charger points. We'll be updating those points just a little later on. Key factor is that under the current weather conditions, Elliott is very strong and is dominating the field. Let's find out by how much and see what's happening behind him. Here to call the action is Ken Squad.
Thanks again, Dave Despain. Bill Elliott out in front. Terry Labonte maintaining that second spot. Now it's Dale Earnhardt back into the second position. Here's Elliott running in first, and Pat Patterson has some more details about this effort in first place.
It's a family affair for the Elliott's. Dan Elliott's here. Dan, the car seems to be handling wonderfully. You're doing a good job.
Yeah, we're going to run high for the race, though, and the second high is going to be something. I can't see the marks on the wall coming off of turn 2, but I can see them coming off of turn 4. That race pass out of the
Okay, Dan Elliott.
So the Elliott family of Dawsonville, Georgia, have their fingers crossed, as does that entire cosmopolitan area. All 600 of them up there, glued to the phone, including the grandmother, watching this afternoon to see if Elliott's going to do it once again. Pride of Georgia, Elliott in first, carrying the Ford hopes at the present time.
Well, I've had several visits with Bill Elliott in Dawsonville, Georgia. I knew him before he hit the big time. You know, I knew him where Bill Elliott, old dirt track racer, good old boy. And my kids sort of grew up with Bill, and Bill loves my boy Scott Zach, takes him down for 2 or 3 weeks with him. And I can tell you that every everybody said Bill Elliott's not that fearsome competitor. Well, they're absolutely wrong. He is a fearsome competitor. I played him in basketball, and he ripped my brand new shirt completely off my body. So he wants to win at basketball, and he doesn't know how to dribble. He walks all the time. Now he's running.
You get him and Rooster Ingram down there at the service station. Look out. Bill Elliott is out in front, and he is making history right now as he tries to draw away. Meanwhile, in second place and moving well away from Terry Labonte is Dale Earnhardt. Labonte is maintaining third, and Morgan Shepherd is closing in. Morgan Shepherd is closing in, that number 26, that Quaker State Buick, moving up on the Junior Johnson colors. Lake?
I think the track is coming back to Morgan again, it looks like to me a little bit. I've been watching him. He had really buried his line for quite some time now. And the other guys have been kind of shuffling around. They started out low on the track, and they've been moving around. But he's just running that steady, consistent pace, and it's starting to move him right on back towards the front again.
Morgan Shepherd closing up for third spot, and he just seemed to drive up that racetrack, almost head-on toward the wall, about 140 miles an hour, as Terry Labonte in number 11 stays just in front of him. Terry Labonte, what's it like when you get to halfway in this race?
Well, it always seems if your car's really working good and you're running up in the front, the race goes by a lot faster than if maybe you're out there and you've got a problem, you're fighting your car, it's not working good. If you're having a day like that, it's awful long, but hopefully the car will be working good and it won't seem too long.
It's a long way to go right now as he feels the pressure of Morgan Shepherd being exerted in this Buick car. That team has had a lot of problems this year, but now they seem to be on their way back. Meanwhile, up in front, Elliott has his all his own way. Benny Parsons continues to ride with a super flow in car camera. We'll be back with more in a moment. Back with you once again, past the halfway point here in the AC Delco 500. And for the present moment, this man in number 9, Bill Elliott, is commanding the race, trying to give Ford its sixth victory in the AC Delco 500. Only one other, Mark, has ever won more races here. That's Chevrolet with a total of 8. They've won the last 2 years in a row. They won it in 80 and 83 as well, and 79 for that matter. Started their winning ways back in 1975 with the Chevys. The Fords go way back to 65 when they started to win. In fact, in those days, 65, 6, and 7, John, it was all Ford on this racetrack.
Well, the Fords have been magnificent cars at certain racetracks. One thing that we've seen, though, since Earnhardt came on the scene with the awesome team that they put together, they're the only Chevrolet really in the business that's dominated the sport. And Fords have been good cars all year and will continue to be, even with the new rules change coming up.
Pat Patterson filed a report earlier. Here's Bill Elliott. One of the big stories here is this man, number 75, Joe Rutland, who was driving for the injured Neil Bonnett. And the subject defending champion who got hurt and his replacement having such high hopes. The defending champion in this race, Neil Bonnett, not here today. And Pat Patterson can tell us more about it.
2 weeks ago today, a hard crash into the Charlotte Motor Speedway wall left Neil Bonnett with a badly broken leg. Joe Rutman, who filled in for Richard Petty earlier this year, is Neil's replacement today. He's becoming the designated hitter of Winston Cup Racing.
I would think if the game was on the line, you'd want to send the guy to the plate that was going to send the thing out of the ballpark. So hopefully they're contacting me saying that I know he's got the capabilities of doing that, winning that race for us. So that makes me feel real good that such people as Richard Petty and Valvoline would have the confidence along with Raymock to say, hey, let's give Joe this opportunity. On the other hand, in the circumstances you step into, you know, with Neil's position, that's not good. But there's no question everybody knows where Neil stands with the team and the car. So I feel good about that.
Car number 75, being driven by Joe Rutman. In the hospital, out of the hospital, home watching the telecast today, is Neil Bonnett.
Well, this is Johnny Hayes, and I certainly would like to say something to Neil Bonnett. We tried to call, tried to get in touch with him, and we couldn't. But I do want to say one thing about Neil Bonnett that would sum him up for most people in stock car racing. Neil Bonnett is one of the class and in the sport. He's not only one of the best drivers, he's probably one of the best PR overall people in the sport. And if you gave me my choice of any driver overall, top to bottom, corporate relations, pit crew relations, race car driver, I'm going with Neil Bonnett as my driver.
quoted at the hospital. He says, I'm just walking around on crutches up and down the halls here at the hospital. I just go until I can't go no more. I just want to get back and go racing. Blake?
I'll tell you what. Let's add just one thing to that Neil Bonnet story. There's been a lot of talk about the extent of Neil Bonnet's injury. He has suffered a very painful injury called a fragmentation fracture of the proximal femur. If you're not a medical school graduate like our friend Johnny Hayes, you probably don't know that that is a break in his right leg, right up by the hip socket. It's up in the fat part of the leg bone. And the thing that's significant about it is that that is one of the most protected parts of the body. That tells you that Neil Bonnet in that car took a tremendous lick at Charlotte. The reason the break was so bad, Neil had his foot flat on the gas and just was ready to come off the throttle when he hit the wall, but he in fact hit the wall with that leg absolutely stiff, and all the impact went right up the femur and right into the top of the hip socket. It is a serious, serious injury. It has been put back together with screws and pins and plates, and the good news is they forecast with a good bit of therapy that Neil Bonnet will make a 100% recovery from a hard lick that he took at Charlotte, and I think that message right there says it for all of us here at WTBS.
If you'd like to drop him a line, it's just Bessemer, Alabama. The postman knows him well. Neil Bonnet, Bessemer, Alabama. Here in the race number 9, Elliott has just put a lap on the man running in 8th place. Ricky Rudd has gone one lap down. There you see Rudd, and Elliott just drove on by.
Well, the thing you're running into again is Elliott's got to break away now because his car's perfect, just like Dale Earnhardt. He's out to lap a lot of people right now.
Meanwhile, battle developing, third position. Terry Labonte is there in number 11, and look who's coming on. It's Morgan Shepherd at number 26, drops the Buick on the bottom of the racetrack and begins to make ground on Texas Terry. Here they are out of turn number 4, back to the line. The Junior Johnson car out in front, the Kenny Bernstein car tucked right in behind him. Good scramble going on. This happening at lap 277 on the outside where he likes it, right up against the wall. Here comes Morgan Shepherd pressing, trying to move up another spot and making it. Great run by Shepherd here today.
Well, Morgan found out yesterday that was the line and it will work late in the race, and he used that experience from yesterday to pick up that position.
Here he is going around car number 64, Curtis Markham. Back to the inside comes Terry Labonte. He wants another shot at third spot. Back straight away, Shepherd holds him off for the moment. So, as they now stand, Bill Elliott is in first for Ford. Dale Earnhardt is in second for Chevrolet. And third for Buick, it's Morgan Shepherd. More of the AC Delco 500 shortly. Benny Parsons running in 18th position, giving you these pictures from the Superflow in-car camera, Super Oil Motor Oil, here at a record crowd enjoying this race. And the next event upcoming is also on the Superstation from Riverside, California. It's the Western 500, the Winston Western 255 Eastern on Sunday, November 8th. Join us here on the Superstation for all the action, live flag-to-flag coverage from California for the next to last race in the 1988 Winston Cup campaign. Now, on the back straightaway, you're following the battle that's taking place between Harry Gant in number 33, currently ninth, Phil Parsons, the number 55 in 10th, and just behind them is the Ruttman car in 11th. Here's Harry Gant in number 33, trying to keep Phil Parsons a spot back.
Well, they've been racing side by side for about 50 laps, and Phil just can't get around Harry. And the thing is getting ready to happen. Here are two of the best cars on the racetrack, and Bill Elliott is coming up quick, and they're in the danger of getting lapped. You see Bill Elliott in the background making a move, and they've got to go through traffic.
And there's Gant in the line that he likes very much on this track. Seen him successful up there on that side. Benny Parsons is back on pit road in car number 35. That car that's carrying her in-car camera. And there you see them sudsing the window a little here, trying to give him better visibility out of the Folgers car. Back straightaway, Phil Parsons still charging along. And there you see the number 75, Joe Ruttman in 11. And here comes Elliott putting a lap on Ruttman at this point, or attempting to do so in heavy traffic. Much room to run through there. Curtis Markham down on the inside. And having to lift a little is number 9, Elliott. He scoops from the bottom up, goes through the eye of the needle, takes the high side. I don't think I'd want to do that.
Well, this is when you're hoping strongly, if you're the people right in front of Elliott, for that caution. But if he gets by you, you hope the caution doesn't come out. Elliott is smart enough not to press it. He's going to wait through until he gets through that traffic. He will not take it three deep. If that would have been Dale Earnhardt, he'd have already been gone, or some people had gone sideways or something, but you could have kissed him goodbye.
Do you think he's a dirty driver?
No, I don't. I think he's aggressive. I think he's a hero-type driver. I think he's probably like Hank Williams Jr. sings music, or Waylon Jennings. I mean, they go for it, but everybody buys their records.
Car number nine, Bill Elliott on the outside, getting a lap on Rutten. I love to watch him run. I think it's back to the days of Curtis Turner Jr. when you see Earnhardt really turning him on. But a lot of people get very upset about some of his tactics.
Oh, yeah, they get upset at him, but they still respect him. It's like that story. You don't have to like me, just respect me. And I tell you, everybody on pit road respects the man. He's one of the greatest race car drivers that ever lived.
Well, he sure has a lot of people looking out their back window instead of their front in a lot of races.
And you would, too, if you were driving right in front of him.
Dale Earnhardt is running in second to this man, Bill Elliott, in car number nine. And there he is back there. We'll give you an interval between first and second to see what Earnhardt has to cope with in trying to win his 12th race of 1988. Shepherd in the third, Labonte fourth, Darrell Walter fifth, Buddy Baker sixth, Kyle Petty in seventh, and Ricky Rudd is in the eighth position now. There you see Elliott trying to stretch it out for his fifth win of the season. I have it as about, 13 seconds? Let's see if we can see that interval here and give you a perspective on what it is to the fans. Ah, Elliott's on the pit road. Take it away. I thought we were about 2 to 3 laps away from coming in on pit road. Not the case. Joe Ruttman is also in. Leader is in. And we have a new leader. It's Dale Earnhardt. Here's Pat Patterson.
Bill Elliott's crew goes to work on the right side of the car. Butch Stevens, Dan Elliott, the whole crew making that right side pit change. Now, this is going to be awfully critical here because when he goes back out, the leaders are going to be in front of him. If they get a caution, it could put Elliott in big trouble, but he's down and away with a good stop.
13 8/10 seconds is that good stop. And back underway, Elliott, which puts Earnhardt first, Shepherd up to second, Labonte into third, Waldrop into fourth. There's the new leader. Dale Earnhardt now in front. Dale, will your experience driving a loose car help you in this race here today, this AC Delco 500?
It ran good here in the spring on hard tires, and the racetrack was a little bit slippery and unpredictable, but, it's a little bit different this time. Everybody's having the trouble. I've been having the trouble myself, so, it's just who can adjust the best and say the most consistent. And hopefully, Richard and all the guys do the job they've been doing all year, we can do that.
Kyle Petty is on pit road. Ricky Rudd is also on pit road with the Budmore Motorcraft car. So the Fords are coming in. Staying out is Earnhardt in the lead, and Morgan Shepherd, who seemed to have tremendous range when last we checked in on that Kenny Bernstein car, the Larry McReynolds crew chief machine.
Well, there were several cars that ran a longer distance. I think Jeff Bodine got the longest run. He ran about 105, 106 laps, so that's sort of a benchmark if you are getting that kind of gas mileage.
Yeah, Terry Labonte was the other one, too, that was really out there almost as long as Jeff. What do you think? That Ford's going to take it. Here's Waltrip, Darrell Waltrip on pit road, who has been running fourth. How's this thing setting up, gentlemen?
Looks like Harry Gant slowed coming down the straightaway, and I think he's run out of gas.
Harry Gant appears to have run out of gas. He's down in front of us going into turn number one, bottom of the racetrack. And that's a long coast all the way. I don't think he's going to. Is he pitting on the backside?
Pitting on the backstretch.
Now he's okay. He'll get in. Here's Gant trying to get her in.
The way Harry's luck's gone this year, that doesn't surprise me. He's run well in a lot of races, but just can't get a break. If there's a problem, he's right in the middle of it.
Gant coming down on the pit road, and yet he's won 3 races in the Grand National Series. So whatever the problems, it wouldn't seem to be with the driver.
No, Harry Gant's a class driver. He's always been, always will be, and they've had a few little problems, but they are bringing them together.
Earnhardt on pit road. Leader is on pit road. Dale Earnhardt pulls in. And Pat Patterson's there.
Okay, it'll be the right side of the car. They'll change 2 tires there. We don't see anybody going inside like speed to make any kind of chassis adjustment on Earnhardt's car, so apparently he's happy with the way it's set up. And this is Kurt Shelverdine and the crew. 2 tires, and the car will be down and away.
Any changes that need to be made on the car, I think, at this point stage, can be done with the changes of the tire stagger.
13 9/10 seconds was that stop on Dale Earnhardt. Sterling Marlin is also pitting. And so this is the opportunity for these guys to come in, refuel their cars, take on tires, and there is the new leader. It's Morgan Shepherd back in front another time, and he has the range. See how that plays itself out by the end of this race.
You
may be set up pretty well. When you get out of sync just slightly with the rest of the field in pit stop, sometimes it works to your advantage. He is not pitting at this time, coming by with Buddy Arrington directly behind him. We'll be back with more of the action here this afternoon of the AC Delco 500, which for the moment has Morgan Shepherd in first, Terry Labonte in second. So stay with us.
A break in the action here in Rockingham for Bobby Hillen, but it's a bad break. He has blown the motor. That car had been all over the racetrack during the commercial break. It may have been leaking oil. He is down onto pit road with an apparent blown motor, and that'll drop him out of the competition. Out front, Morgan Shepherd is stretching the long legs on his number 26 machine. Tremendous gas mileage as we pass now the 300 lap mark in this 492 lap epic here at Rockingham. Gas mileage could be key for Morgan. Labonte has just pitted. That's going to drop him down somewhere in here. Elliott and Earnhardt still may have the two strongest cars in the field. Let's get back to the action with Ken Squire.
Bobby Hillen's car being rolled down pit road. It's terminal on that machine. As we check attrition, I believe that would be the seventh car out of the race. Eighth car out is the Hillen car as it goes behind the wall. Shepherd staying in front. He's got a... There are the cars out of the race. Davey Allison out very early. He burned the rear end up on that one. Brett Bodine was in two incidents and went away. J.D. McDuffie had some problems. Bobby Allison out early, which could change the top 10 standings. Cale Yarborough, a victim of this race. He badly needs a win. Dave Simcoe was in trouble spinning a couple of times. Butch Miller, who's had a great season on short tracks, has retired. And now we're watching as car number 26, Morgan Shepherd, pulls on pit road, the leader. Here's Jerry Jarrett.
Well, Ken, this is a significant pit stop. Morgan's managed to go 10 laps longer than anybody else. With this kind of mileage, he only needs to make one more stop the rest of the race to go the distance. Putting in two cans of fuel, outside tires, no chassis change, back out, less than 17 seconds.
He is away. We had that as just about 18 seconds on that stop.
I want to correct you on the chassis change, too. He did a major chassis change when they removed their rear spoiler just then. So evidently the car was a little loose because they pushed the spoiler up. So
they got it up, trying to get a little more downforce on it?
Need a little bit more downforce in the back. Looks like we've lost another one over out of turn two. It's Richard Petty.
Ah, smoldering. Down the back stretch. Richard Petty, they say, has spun, and they may be bringing out a caution flag here on car number 43. No sign of a yellow as yet. Now the caution is coming out. Reviewing further back in the field for you now. The competitors still in the race. Across the bottom of your screen, Richard Petty is back underway, but he has forced the sixth caution of the afternoon.
Well, a lot of people were very fortunate on that one because Morgan Shepherd about had the field lapped.
Yes, he did. He was just about in position to really take control of this race, that extra range on that one.
That's right.
So, as they now have them, it would be Elliott in first, Earnhardt in second, and Shepherd maintaining third. With fourth spot, Terry Labonte, and fifth, Darrell Waltrip, after the stops under green, and immediately, Elliott's the first man back on pit road. There you see right side rubber going on the Ford. Winner here in 1984 and a photo finish over here again. And there you see the Folgers car, in-car camera in there. And Elliott is getting ready to... Ah, they're coming all the way around. Left side tires.
Well, again, they just changed two under green. This gives them opportunity to get everything set up perfect again. And most cars will try to get in and take four tires, I think.
There is Elliott coming back on.
I think they had trouble on the back stretch on the pit road.
Well, there it is. That's that Markham car, Curtis Markham, out of Richmond, Virginia, having a problem. And this will hold them up a bit more and give some other people a chance to go in here. The frenzy of feeding time continues on pit road for fuel and tires on these cars. As Conrad 15 comes in another time, Ricky Rudd, Rutman is in, Earnhardt comes in again, Petty, the Jarrett car. Jarrett is one of the most interesting sponsors out there, Coates and Clark. It sounds like a legal firm.
It's a sewing thread firm, and they're capitalizing on the ladies' market, which is about 45% of the live gate now.
There are a couple of keys to Dale Earnhardt's title, which he has won today for the second straight year, third time in his career. Dale Earnhardt is the national champion. And those keys are crew chief Kurt Chalverdine and a master engine builder, Lou DeRosa. They told Dave Despain why their team is so good.
Everybody on the team is optimistic. Everybody is, doesn't have any guilt trips or ego trips, either one. They're all just working towards the same goal, and we all get along reasonably well, except for me and Lou. We hate each other. No, I'm just kidding. You know, that's the whole attitude. When you walk in our place, you sort of get that feeling that we think we're unbeatable, provided everything goes right, and that's the way it ought to be. I think a lot of teams are lacking that.
Teams that I've worked for in the past and Kurt worked for, you have people come in and they don't look at it as a business. It's just a sideline for them. They do well, they fall down, they do well, they're in and out, and they shuffle people around. We try to make our team work because everybody in there is concerned with winning and racing, and that's our primary objective. We don't have any other business, or Richard doesn't, other than racing. So our team is oriented to making that race car run well.
As a championship team's success grows, so does the size of the offers to hire away key members like Chalverdine and LaRosa. There were rumors this year that Kirk and Louie were listening to those offers.
You know, in this sport, money talks. And everybody at Richard Childress wears a hearing aid. We don't hear very much.
With you live once again. A quick thought from Johnny Hayes about that team.
Well, first of all, I'd like to set the stage on that conversation right there. Louie LaRosa from Brooklyn, New York. Can you imagine Curtis Turner and Fireball sitting there saying the top engine builder, one of the top, is from Brooklyn? I love it. Brooklyn, you should be happy you got one of the best in the business.
Let's go down
absolutely.
The STP Pit Center. Here's Dave Despain.
I'm here with Kenny Bernstein. Kenny's on one radio. I'm going to see if I can get him to stick another one on here. Kenny, can you put this on real quick? I need to ask you very quickly, if you can hear me. I know you're on the radio to Morgan Shepherd. You guys are getting tremendous gas mileage. Can you win this race?
Well, I think so. It's going to be tough. You know, a couple of cars ahead of us, but he's driving a heck of a race. The crew's getting him in and out of the pits. I hope the Quaker State Buick can bring it home.
You almost put him a lap down there. That yellow took that right away from you.
It's funny how you get up here and spot. You want the yellow to come out when everybody else comes in, and then when you come in, you don't want to come out, but we just missed it.
Quickly, you're a drag racer. How are you liking this roundy-round business by now?
Well, I like it. It's tough, but we're having a lot of fun.
All right, go back to work. Kenny's on the radio there to his driver, Morgan Shepherd, who, when we come back, is going to see if he can use that long gas mileage, those long legs on that Buick, to perhaps run down the leaders, Elliott and Earnhardt.
And he'll have to run from sixth position when they come back under a green flag, David. Bill Elliott will be first. Kyle Petty will be in second. Dale Earnhardt in third. Darrell Walter fourth. Buddy Baker fifth. Morgan Shepherd in the sixth position when they're ready for resumption of the event. And Terry Labonte is in seventh. Seven cars in the lead lap when we get ready to resume here today at the AC Delco 500. One lap away. There's the signal from Harold Tender as we bring you live flag-to-flag coverage of this great race at the North Carolina Motor Speedway. Let's go to Jerry Garrett.
Well, we talked down here to Larry McReynolds, the crew chief for Morgan Shepherd, and asked him why they were beating on that spoiler, trying to bend it back up. So I guess the car tends to get a little too loose. They're trying to tighten it back up. When they came back in the second time, they bent it up some more. So apparently it needed a major change, and they hope this is it.
Well, Ken, let me follow up on the Lou LaRosa story. One of the great parts of that whole story is that was me that asked that question to try to stir up trouble among their team. I used every cheap shot I could to cause trouble. Nobody wants Lou and nobody wants Kirk because nobody could ever buy him away from Richard Childress. They love the man, their family, and Dale Earnhardt said, you take one of them, all of us will go.
Really thought you were going to get Lou LaRosa to leave town, leave that team after they won two championships, John? They knew they had this one.
Well, he's one of my heroes, Brooklyn, New York, Louie LaRosa.
You know, a lot of people don't realize that Lou was building the motors when Dale won his first national championship as well,
back in 1980. Now we're back under green. Bill Elliott out in front. He was leading at halfway in this event, and over the years, a total of seven drivers have led halfway and then gone on to win, starting with Curtis Turner back in 1965. The last guy to lead at halfway and then bring it home, Walter, 1981. Here's Elliott trying to make
history repeat itself. Ricky Rudd's back alive. I think they got his car fixed again, and he's going to be trying hard to get this lap back and get back with the boys.
Well, there he is. He's one lap down, and he's trying to make it up as you watch Elliott there. And you see the Waltrip number 17. There's that number 5 car, which is down a couple of laps, as I recall, down. At least two.
Yes, he is. And Kyle Petty is still running right up front. He's followed by Joe Russell.
And in these races that take a lot of time and a lot of energy, Kyle's been doing better and better. Won the 600, the Coca-Cola race at Charlotte this year. He could be a real factor before it's over, too.
It's just amazing to see how little bitty things, like, you know, you stop thinking the car's perfect. The guy's out there running, the motor's running perfect, the car's driving perfect, and then you change four tires, and the stagger's a little different, and all of a sudden you're not so perfect anymore. You're lapped. Now here's Ricky Rudd's a perfect example. They come back in, they get an opportunity to put four tires on instead of a two-tire green stop change that could throw your car off. Put four tires on, get back with the right setup, and they're as fast as anybody on the racetrack.
Dale Earnhardt now running in second position, trying to chase down number 9, Bill Elliott, which is just in front of that Ricky Rudd car. We asked Dale about the rumors of that team perhaps breaking up at the end of this year with the tremendous financial pressures.
I think it's one member that all of us go together. You know, it's a situation where we know we're a team and we know that we're not going to be as strong without any member, and I don't think any member could leave there and be as strong as we are. They know they'd have a tough act to follow if they left there and went somewhere else because they're getting a lot on their shoulders to produce like we're doing now. It takes more than one man to make that show go. And, I'm not doing it by myself. You know, Rosa and Kurt and the rest of them aren't either. Richard's a good organizer, he's a good planner, and if he works well with his team members, I think he keeps them all happy. Hopefully, they'll be there for a while.
That confirms what you said, John Hayes.
Well, absolutely. And I think one fact that's a startling fact is no key person has left that team in 5 years. There's a lot of changes, but not one key person has left that race team in 5 years. That's why they're the best pit crew in racing and one of the best race teams in racing.
But six-figure contracts being offered, hundreds of thousands of dollars for some of those people that keep getting rumored, for the engine man, La Rosa, for Shelverty, even for Cecil Gordon. I don't mean even for Cecil Gordon, because I think he's important. But it's amazing that Childress can keep them all playing that same game on that same team with the kind of dollars that are being. I think the great line was, someone said, and it might have been Shelverdine, we have our hearing aids turned very, very low.
Yes, well, Richard Childress is fair to them. They love Richard Childress. Everybody in racing respects and likes Richard Childress, and that's one of the keys, and you're afraid to roll the dice because you go, you hear this great offer. We've seen other people do it. You switch from a comfortable situation. Last 1 year, you're gone in your history at that spot, and they don't want to gamble. Dale Earnhardt doesn't want to gamble. Nobody wants to gamble that they are the team and so great.
Earnhardt stays in second spot and tries to close on Bill Elliott. The interval is about four and a half seconds. Right now, we'll see if he can do it shortly. Laps, 332 miles have been completed here this afternoon. We have 165 laps remaining to be run here this afternoon in the AC Delco 500. There's your leader, number 9, Bill Elliott, who won in 84. And here's the interval from Bill Elliott in number 9 back to the second place man, Dale Earnhardt in the yellow and blue Chevrolet, which is still seeking a first win for Earnhardt on this track. And maintaining third is car number 17. That is the Darrell Waltrip car, which you see right there on the bottom of the screen behind the lap car. Now let's go back to the battle between fifth and sixth. That's Buddy Baker. And on the outside, Morgan Shepherd for fifth and sixth. And it is Shepherd taking the spot away from Baker in car number 88. Moving up another slot, another time, the Buick goes by the Oldsmobile. It's Shepherd around Baker. They are all in the lead lap, as is the seventh place car, Terry Labonte. Number 15, Ricky Rudd, is right up there behind the leader, which is number 9, Elliott, trying to make his lap back up, but not being very successful.
Well, this is key time for Ricky. He hopes that Elliott will slow, his tires will go away, and he'll be able to get the lap back like Buddy Baker did earlier.
I think right there, you know, this whole situation, we're watching the 26 car, then we're watching the 15 car. The 26 car has been a consistent race all day long. It's never, even at his worst points, it's never been very far off. He's still in the lead lap. Ricky's run real flashy. He's run real, real well at times. Then other times, they've missed a combination and fell off. Now he's a lap down. The consistency is what pays off and wins these races. You've got to be there every time under any condition.
The driver of the Kmart car, Lake Speed, is with us. And off to my right here, John Hayes. I'm Ken Squire. And covering the STP pit center is Dave Despain. Along pit road is Pat Patterson and Jerry Garrett. And our Goodrich updates to Bob Richards this afternoon. It's live racing action for the most competitive automobile racing in the world. Winston Cup competition coming to you from The Rock, the North Carolina Motor Speedway at Rockingham. And in the AC Delco 500, a Ford is out in front. It is a Chevrolet in second and in third, with a Ford in fourth, a Buick in fifth, an Oldsmobile in sixth. The driver's names, they are the legends of American stock car racing. A new legend, Bill Elliott, who came on 3 or 4 years ago. $1 million Bill in front. Dale Earnhardt, who this afternoon waltzed in for a check for $550,000 when he cranked the engine, came out and started the race and won the Winston Cup championship for the third time in his career. Darrell Waltrip, a three-time Grand National winner, is in that third spot. Then Kyle Petty is fourth from a great racing tradition. In the fifth spot is Morgan Shepherd. Sixth is Buddy Baker. Seventh, Terry Labonte. The distance, 333 laps now covered. And Elliott's interval stays about the same. Morgan Shepherd had that caution not come out the last time. That sixth caution of the day would have been able to put a lap on the field. This man right here. But it did not fall his way. So many things don't fall Morgan Shepherd's way, John.
Well, when you're an aggressive race car driver, I think you saw Morgan go a little bit sideways right there. When you're an aggressive race car driver like Morgan is, you live by the sword, you die by the sword. He'll take chances, he'll stick it in. That's what makes Dale Earnhardt so phenomenal. He will stick it in and come out. He told me if he sees a wreck, he aims right for it. By the time he gets to it, it's gone. That's how aggressive he is. He says, I never lift, I go for it. A lot of people lift and get in trouble.
Let's go to Dave Despain.
Here in the STT Pit Communications Center, watching Darrell Waltrip running in third and recalling that Darrell has won this race three times, 1981, 82, and 85. All three times he went on to win the Winston Cup Championship. One of his keys is surrounding himself with good people. This week, he found some good people. One guy in particular available to work, and Pat Patterson has that. Well, we've got problems on the racetrack.
Yes, we do. Crispin's number 62 has wrecked hard on the backside out of turn two. I think he got up in the wall and came bouncing back across. Now, that is unfortunate. That one looks like it really is in bad shape. Steve Crispin of Fort Wayne, Indiana, was running 28. And let's see what happened here. There's that turn two, which has reached out and bitten so many over the years. And
fatal mistake was made when he tried to save that thing on the second go-round.
Took the inside wall. Took the inside wall. And Crispin making a pretty hard effort this year.
One wiggle, you can sometimes save them. The second wiggle is a lot worse than the first one, usually.
Take us back through that, Lake. We'll look at it again. Lake Speed alongside today. And show us where that second wiggle was, that second correction that was the overcorrection.
I think you'll see how much more violent the second.
Here's swing around is. Four tire change. And here's another look. Lake.
Watch, he's out now. He's going for it, trying to save it. But he's got to have the steering wheel cranked so far to the right, there was no way. You know, and you're down there in an oil dry now, you're history.
What do you think about when you see that coming up, Lake?
You try not to ever get in a position where you have to see that.
But when you do see that, what do you think?
When you get that second wiggle and you know it's coming, you just grit your teeth and say, uh-oh, here we go. Ride her out and see how bad it's going to be.
Here's Dave Despain.
Let's finish that Darrell Waltrip story. He knows good people when he sees them. He found an opportunity this week, and Pat Patterson has the story of Darrell's newest crew member down on pit road.
Well, it's been a controversial week for Davey Allison, and the man who was in the middle of that controversy is Joey Knuckles. What does Joey Knuckles do 1 week later? Out of work, he's in Darrell Waltrip's pit changing the front tires. Earlier, Dave Despain had an opportunity to talk and find out why this has been such a dismal week for Davey Allison.
Rookie crew chief Joey Knuckles had a boyhood dream. He grew up in the garages of American stock car racing, pals with Davey Allison. When they were 10, Davey said, Joey, someday I'm going to drive one of these cars. And Joey answered, I want to be your crew chief. Fate made it happen. The kids won two races this year. But this week, while Davey was out of town on business, the boyhood dream was shattered. Knuckles was fired.
I talked to Joey the other night on the telephone for about an hour and let him know that, you know, I still am his friend. And I wish I could have been there with him, you know, to give him a little bit of support. But he knows now that I care a great deal about him and about what happens to him. And I told him over the phone and would like to have been able to tell him in person that I hope everything works out good for him and he gets the best deal that can come along.
The team says Knuckles was fired because the chemistry wasn't right. Allison says he couldn't have helped his friend if he had been around.
I couldn't have interfered. There's no way I could put myself in a position to interfere with what goes on in the shop. I'm the driver for this racing team. My job is to go out and drive this car, and that's what I got to go do. And then from there on out, you got to forget about it. You got to say, okay, we're friends. We're not part of the same race team anymore, but we're going to remain friends and forget about it. Let it go.
And with me is Joey Knuckles. Joey, I know that this has been a disappointing week for you. You say you've managed to find something to do Sunday afternoon for Darrell Waltrip, but what kind of week has it been, Joey?
Well, it's really been heartbreaking. You know, I prepared my whole life for this, and then I got fired. So I'm down here helping my man Eddie Dickerson. He hurt himself in the pit crew race yesterday, and I'm having fun.
What is the future of Joey Knuckles?
I'd like to take a rookie and win Rookie of the Year. I really do believe in the youth movement, and I believe that's where it's at. And, you know, I'm going to miss Davey Allison.
It's Joey Knuckles.
At the AC Delco 500, getting ready for resumption of the race. Bill Elliott leading, Morgan Shepherd in second, Kyle Petty is third. And we'll be back with more in a moment. The Superflow's Motor Oil's in-car camera in the Folgers car, number 35 of Benny Parsons, under caution here as we get ready to go once again. I think we're one lap away from turning them loose in an interesting situation developing up in front. Car 35 that you were just looking from is in 18th position. Now, as they double file, there you see Earnhardt now on the bottom end of the lead lap. Up in front, let's go to the front of this little group. The front man is Elliott in number 9, with Shepherd in second and Kyle Petty in third. But directly in front of Elliott, up in that lead lap as they begin to pull up, is car number 15. And that number 15 car,
so car 15 has just lost the engine, I think, right there under caution.
Oh, that's too bad. He was ready to make up his lap. Car number 15, Ricky Rudd, was just in front of Elliott, getting ready to get to him and set the picture here. He's in trouble, and the caution is back out again. The yellow is coming on another time. We'll have another lap under caution. So Ricky Rudd in a position to make up his lap. Has it go away as the engine grinds itself to pieces in the back straightaway?
Yeah, when it came through the second turn over there is when the smoke started erupting from the back bumper. You knew that it was, you know, something serious.
I noticed another car was pushing him around to help him get around. That's got to be tough for Ricky because he drove his heart out to get back in there, and he was just where he thought he could hold him off, and then goes on you.
They'd done a good pit job there, strategy, and got him out in front. And he just showed us prior to that he could run with the leader, and, you know, lap for lap. So he would have been in a good position to get his lap, get back in the lead lap, and be in contention to win the race.
Indeed, he was second here a year ago, and he made 9 performances in this race. And have it end that way. That's really too bad. The Budmore team, of course, is a different look for next year. A lot of changes for next year.
Well, I think the shakeups are going around. Budmore, of course, has Brett Bodine coming in to his stable, and he's got to be a young driver, but he has someone that really wants to drive that race car, wants to work with them, and feels like it's an opportunity of a lifetime. And those kind of situations usually turn out to be positive.
Yes, it really does. You know, something y'all were talking about earlier about the children's team, as far as things that make things happen, no amount of money could be paid to any of these guys to get them to do this job. They do it because they want to win. When you're in a situation where you're the winner, where are you going to go?
They are the champions. That's Earnhardt team. Here's Jerry Garrett.
Well, down here on pit road, the word on Ricky Rudd's car is that they lost a water hose or something, and all the water came out of the engine. So they're going to try and repair that and get it back out there. He had some other problems, though. They're out of tires. And they and the Wood brothers are also out of tires. They've been going up and down pit road trying to buy more tires from people. Got their checkbook out down here. I don't know if that's going to be a problem as we come down to the end or not.
We knew that was going to happen before the race started. We discussed that up here earlier, that what happened is the scuffed tires are not working here. They will not hold the racetrack. So everybody practiced a lot and used up a lot of tires. And new tires are the only thing that will stick to that racetrack. So therefore, Goodyear brought in every tire they had from Ohio, everywhere, but couldn't get enough tires.
We'll be back with more of the AC Delco 500 from the North Carolina Motor Speedway at Rockingham here on the Superstation after these words.
We're back at the North Carolina Motor Speedway in Rockingham, and Ricky Rudd has just pulled off the racetrack into the garage. The diagnosis is a blown water hose. Could be a $30,000 water hose. Ricky is fifth in the point standings, but Rusty Wallace is right behind him and could pass him. The difference in the fifth and sixth place points, 30 grand in points by money. Terry Labonte is trying to catch Bill Elliott in a race for $225,000. That's the difference between second and third in the standings. He was right up there at the head of the field early. He's kind of dropped back into the field. I want to know what's happening with Terry Labonte, and Pat Patterson may be able to shed some light on that, Pat.
Well, this is Tim Brewer. He's the crew chief on Terry's car. Tim, you're still in the top five, but the car's not running as well as it was. What's the problem?
It's typical Rockingham racetrack. You know, we've had to change the car a couple of times today, and basically doing the same thing everybody else is, you know, chasing the racetrack, trying to find the chassis combination you're going to need for the last 100 miles. We have been exceptionally good at times, and, you know, we got a little bit loose right there at the last run and got a little bit behind, but fortunately, we've got a little ways to go yet, and hopefully we can pick it back up.
Well, these are the guys that can get it done when it comes down to that last pit stop, and they'll be the ones to try to get Terry up front.
Here's Terry Labonte, currently in fourth position. What a bad break for Ricky Rudd. We're just about ready to make up a lap, and then it went right out from underneath him.
Well, I'm sure there are a lot of viewers out there today that lost a ton of money in the stock market last week. I lost $6.8 million, me and Boone Pickens and all of us high rollers. You know, your money goes away. But I think all you people that lost a lot of money know how Ricky Rudd feels right now. When you got up Tuesday morning, read that paper and said, oh, my Lord, I'm not rich anymore. I got to get a job again.
Quick update on the tire situation. Morgan Shepherd just bought two from Ricky Rudd when Ricky went off the racetrack. Tires are critical. We have an unconfirmed report that Goodyear is completely out of right side tires. We've got over 100 laps to go to run as we go green.
As we do, Elliott jumps out in front. They were ready to start it 2 laps ago and then took one more look at the racetrack, and Les Richter and Dick Beatty said, I think we better do a little more sprucing to this facility before they turn them loose. And that's what they did.
And Joe Ruffin is trying. He wants that lap back, too, right now. You know, if there's any way he can squeeze a little bit more speed out of that Maverick car, he's going to do it.
There it is, that number 75, a Raymond Racing car that had been driven by Neil Bonnet. Well-constructed machine. It took terrible abuse at Charlotte. Didn't show it, but it hurt one of the toughest drivers in the game, Neil Bonnet. Thanks. There you see the second-place car, the green and white Quaker State colors for Morgan Shepherd. And Kyle Petty is right back there in third spot. And remember that Kyle Petty is assured of moving to eighth place in the Winston Cup standings today past Neil Bonnet and with this AC Delco 500.
You know, the tire situation is going to be critical. It could be the difference in winning or losing this race. And in recent history, we've never had this problem. Goodyear always has way too many tires for what we need. But the key thing is scuffed tires will not run with stickers. So if you come up with stickers, you can win this race.
Stickers being new tires with the stickers still on them when you put them on the racetrack.
Right. We don't want the fans to think that there's not enough tires to go on the cars out here. It's just that the guys, even if they had 12 laps on them, they wouldn't be as good as a set that was brand new. That's what we're trying to get across.
Elliott in first. Shepherd in second. Kyle Petty in third. Terry Labonte in fourth, Waltrip in fifth, Baker in sixth, and Earnhardt still hung out to dry in the back of that group in seventh. And here's Earnhardt trying to close in a little on Buddy Baker in the back as you watch Shepherd up in front. Here's Pat Patterson with more on that story.
I'm with Bill Homer with Goodyear Tires. Bill, you guys brought plenty of tires to this race, but are you out now? What's the story?
Yeah, as of now, we don't have any new tires left. I brought 1,200 tires, which is 400 more than we've ever used before. But there have already been 9 caution flags, so the guys are putting on label tires. They want to put on scuff tires. They're in fine shape that way.
So in other words, everybody went for the sticker tires as opposed to putting on some scuffs and stuff, right?
That plus all the caution flags.
Okay, let's report to Goodyear.
Lake Speed.
the thing, again, I want to come back and reiterate, I'm sure there's people out there saying, what's the matter with a tire that's got 5, 6, 8 laps on it? Well, what happens to a tire is the same thing with metal. Every time it's heated and cooled, it gets harder. And these guys, the track's hard to get a hold of. They want as soft a tire as they can possibly come up with. They don't want one that's already been heat treated.
Earnhardt back there in that seventh position trying to close on Baker. Baker running in sixth. This has been a great run for the Danny Schiff team today. Schiff Baker team in reality. There's that Oldsmobile just in front of the Chevrolet. And you see behind them Alan Kowicki's car number 7, which is now being shown down a couple of laps. We'll be reviewing the full field for you again shortly and also taking another look at the attrition in the race. 88 and 3. Baker the 88, the 3 of Earnhardt, fighting for sixth position there on the tail end of the lead lap. And Earnhardt just can't seem to deal with that old wheel. You'd think he'd want to get on with the program here.
Well, Earnhardt may be in a tire problem also. It may be saving his stickers for the last pit stop. And there's a lot of strategy going on. Maybe the pit road people can find out about that. But I'm sure people are saving tires.
Jerry Garrett and Pat Patterson, you might want to be checking on that. Now, looking back in the 18th position car, this is the car of Benny Parsons, the Folgers machine with that super flow in-car camera. As it goes around the banking. Remember, the banking's different on both ends of this track. It's not the same. You can just set up for one end of the track or the other, whichever one you think you're going to get a better bite on and get a little better opportunity to close some time down.
It's a compromise. You're going to always have to come up with whatever gives you the best overall lap times. Once in a while, you might give away a little bit in the compromise if you can get something that'll help you get to the start-finish line first.
Here we are with the third-place car, Kyle Petty, being challenged by Terry Labonte. Kyle there in that car, number 21. Then the 11 car is Terry Labonte and 17, Waltrip, 3, 4, and 5. Here's Jerry Garrett.
Well, the tire situation down here at Morgan Shepherd's pit is this. They've got one more set of four-tire change. They've got it from cannibalizing everything that they've got left. Right here, they've got one from set 8. They got one from set 5. They got one from set 7 back here. And another one from set 2. They got one full tire change of stickers left. Let's see what the situation is down the Elliott pit with Pat Patterson.
Well, we checked with Elliott's pit. Now, they have a couple of set of sticker tires, but who's the guy that's got the most backed up behind his pits? Dale Earnhardt. He's probably got 5 or 6 sticker tire sets here. And we looked through the Crisco pit. They only had 2. SDP pit only had a couple. And we looked on down to the Jeff Bodine pit. They also have a couple, 3 sets left. So the guy that's got the most tires right now is Dale Earnhardt.
And the guy who has the big lead is Elliott in the number 9 car. There's car number 9 over Morgan Shepherd. Here's that battle that continues for the third spot. Labonte is there. Waltrip in 4th. Kyle Petty in the 5th position, the number 21 car. Kyle Petty now in 5th. Waltrip beginning to meander up through traffic.
I'd like to give Kyle Petty a call. He's run up front all day. He's had a super race. And this is going to be one of those races, if you look down at the top 15 people, you could have a great day and finish 15th, and you read the paper like you had a bad day. And it's like Blake and I talked earlier. That's how many good teams there are. And, you know, it used to be if you weren't a top 5, you didn't have a good day. Now we're saying top 20 is a good day.
And it's not only that. The guy, like I said, he could run all day today, and at the last pit stop, wind up getting the wrong stagger or some little something or another going on, and wind up 15th.
Kyle Petty's best finish here was in 1981 and in 85 when he finished in 6th. He's currently running in 5th and looks like a challenger as this race continues to wind down. 492 laps is the distance. 362 laps have now been completed. 7 cars are in the lead lap. They are Elliott, Shepherd, Labonte, Waltrip, Petty, Earnhardt, and Buddy Baker. 1 lap down in 8th is Jeff Bodine, followed by Joe Ruffin in 9th. Then 2 laps down comes Harry Gant in 10th, Phil Parsons 11th. In 12th is Rusty Wallace, 13th is Sterling Marlin. 3 laps down in 14th spot, Richard Petty, 15th, Ken Schrader, and 16th, 4 laps down is Dale Jarrett. 7 cars in the lead lap, and that's rather remarkable. It's being helped by these caution periods that we have had. 7 today. We'll be back with more of the AC Delco 500 as Bill Elliott goes for his 5th win of the season in a moment.
North Carolina Motor
Motor Speedway and a parade of All-American Iron continue to romp and stomp around this tough one-mile oval that they call the Rock. And for the first time today, no Dale Earnhardt in the top five. It's Elliott Shepard, Lamonte Walter, Petetti running in those top five positions. Earnhardt has fallen outside the top five. Remember, Earnhardt has the full complement of what they call the sticker tires, the new tires that we seem to feel will be one of the keys to victory here. Where did he get the tires? Well, it's a commentary on this team. Early in the race, before anybody started talking about that problem, Bobby Allison dropped out of the competition. And somebody from Richard Childress Opportunity was prescient enough to go down and gobble up all those tires. Now, Richard Childress has made $6 million as a car owner, and that car locked up a $550,000 bonus today. I don't think they're going to have to sell any of those tires, but by looking ahead, by planning, by being the crack crew that they have put themselves in position to lead if, in fact, tires become the key to victory. Earnhardt, though, has got to do some catching up for the first time today. Let's get back to the action now. Here's Ken Squire.
He could probably have one of the most profitable tire companies in the business if he wanted to start right now at this moment.
Well, I think he could, and he'll have a lot of buyers, but he'll be very careful who he sells it to. I have one question. I'm not real smart, but what does the word appreciant mean? He used those big old words.
It means we're getting very long into the lean part of the afternoon. That's what it
and
means.
You know what's scary? He lives in North Georgia, 30 miles from Bill Elliott, and Bill don't talk like that at all.
He's talking about Dave Despain, who lives up in Dahlonega. Here's Earnhardt's number nine. There you see him closing up on car number 21. Earnhardt closing up for fifth spot and going high. That's number three closing on number 21. Number nine, Elliott, your leader. Shepard in second, Lamonte third, Walter fourth. And here you see that battle for fifth. Kyle Petty and Dale Earnhardt.
You know, the clerk has said at the beginning of the race, and every time we talk to him today, that the car's been loose, and it's been loose since they've been here. And obviously, that's the reason that Dale is running the real high line all the time. Late in the race, it may come back to him again here. He's fighting it a little bit right now, but it's starting to show that he's gaining on the crowd again.
Battle beginning to develop between Carr in second place and third, Shepard and Lamonte. There you see Morgan Shepherd being challenged by Terry Lamonte still another time. We're down toward 370 laps complete. The rundown you're seeing at the bottom of the screen is, I think, 346, a complete rundown through the field. There's that Lamonte car again closing up, and the interval is pretty long between first and second place. Lenny Parsons now up to 70.
And I'll tell you, though, if you stop and look at the second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth place, they all smell blood, I think. They realize that it's getting down to that point in the race right now. You better do what you can do and worry about it later, because this thing could go green the rest of the way, and you can't afford to lay back at all right now.
And here comes Lamonte, looking for an inside line. The green Buick on the outside, the red and white Junior Johnson car, the Chevrolet, on the inside for a moment, now tucks back in behind at turn one. And climbing the wall, that's, what, 25 degrees in one. It's a 22-degree bank in turns three and four. Shepard just runs up that wall and hurdles down that back straightaway and leads by a couple of car lengths. Some 60,000 here today. Some 60,000 in attendance. Hey, the sun's coming out again, too. We're getting wrapped in this cloud cover. We've had cloud cover most of the day. The sun broke through for a while. There's the attrition thus far in the race. And the sun condition might change things a little. Allison, the first man out. Brett Bodine, a couple of spins. Butch Miller out. Bobby Wolwack. Steve Crispin had a crash in the back straightaway. Ricky Rudd retired. Looked like he was going to make up a lap. And Curtis Markham out of Richmond, Virginia. Champion over the Old Dominion Speedway in Manassas. Having his problems today.
It looks like the sun pops in, pops out, pops in, pops out. To look at the sky, the clouds are that way, and it's going to continue to be that way the rest of the afternoon.
How do you feel right now in this race, Lake? Late in the going.
You either feel very optimistic, or you wish this thing could hurry up and get over with. One of the two.
Well, there you see Bill Elliott out in front, lapping more cars. Earlier today, we asked Bill Elliott what memories he has of Rockingham.
Remember how hard it was to start with the Cup race. You know, we came here, you know, at that time they had 3 days qualifying, and I qualified all 3 days and finally got in the last day. At that time they started 36 cars and I started 33rd, so I just about didn't make it.
Johnny,
Hayes benefit, increasing an observer watching that first performance by Bill Elliott might have predicted his dominance here today. And yes, Johnny, everybody in North Georgia talks like that. The update on the tires, Earnhardt has 20, the 21 seat right there. Kyle Petty say, hey, we're okay, no problem. 9 car of Bill Elliott, 20 of tires. The 11 car of Terry Labonte in good shape. The car's in trouble. Buddy Baker has not enough tires, enough of the sticker tires again, enough of the top line tires, if you will, to go the distance. And Morgan Shepherd is the one who is desperate. They say they are trying to buy every tire they can find. Here is Earnhardt trying to stomp his way back up to the lead. He dominated this event early on, but now the laps are beginning to wind down, and I think, Ken, the pressure is beginning to build up here. We got to see how good Earnhardt really is.
4 cars running within a half second, and here comes Dale Earnhardt in the number 3, closing on Waltrip in the 17. Earnhardt has finished all but one race in 87, a phenomenal record. But Cale finished all 30 races back in 1977. Look at number 11, Labonte, on the bottom of the racetrack. He's trying to go under the Mark Stahl car in the center. Mark Stahl's car being taken inside and outside. Morgan Shepherd on the outside. Labonte on the inside. And there's Waltrip running just behind them, pressing Earnhardt right to the wall. Incredible racing. Live here on the Superstation, back straight away. Here comes Texas Terry Labonte down on the inside. Morgan Shepherd gets there first. Earnhardt fades high. All 4 cars battling for second place. It's Labonte down at the bottom. Morgan Shepherd right to the wall, blocking Earnhardt. Earnhardt dips to the inside. Great racing here, and Earnhardt slides through. Earnhardt makes the move, incredible. Pulls up through, here comes Waltrip another time. Bottom of the racetrack, 3 deep for a moment. Closing ground, Dale Earnhardt, 3-time Winston Cup champion, moves on the high side of Labonte at turn 3.
Absolutely hustling that car to death right now to get every bit out of it he can. But he's getting really good runs off the corner by running that real high line.
60,000 people on their feet watching this incredible battle. Elliott runs by himself out in front, but here you see the scramble going on for second place. Labonte is there. Earnhardt right behind him in that next spot back, third position overall in the field. Down they go into turn number 3, and again, fading all the way to the wall. Another foot and a half sometimes up there in 3. He's going to take the paint off. Back there just behind the Morgan Shepherd. How do you think Morgan's feeling right now, Lee?
I think Morgan's looking a lot more optimistic, too. He just changed his line here in the last few laps and jumped up there where Dale is. I think he's seen the success there.
And of course, that's where he won yesterday. He won in a photo finish. Morgan Shepherd, that green car, won the Grand National race by inches on that high line that is now being utilized by Dale Earnhardt. It's a dandy.
The racetrack just continues to change, and you just have to continue to chase wherever the most optimum place for you to run is.
And of course, Darrell Waltrip is in this thing. He's running in 5th in that tie car, number 17. Darrell Waltrip, is Dale Earnhardt the man to beat today?
Dale's been tough all year long. You know, he's overshadowed a lot of the hard work that we've done. Just to be 4th in the points and to be where we are. But he's overshadowed a lot of guys in here this year. That happens every year, seems like. But he'll be there, and Bill will be there always, and a couple of others, that, you know, a couple of surprises. Maybe Harry Gant, maybe Bobby Allison, maybe Richard Petty. It's hard to say. There's some guys that don't always qualify well here that are always in the thick of the thing when the race is over.
It isn't Richard Petty, it's Kyle Petty who is a factor in this race. Still running in 6th, Baker in 7th, in the lead left. The lead is 5 6/10 of a second, by which Bill Elliott has this race mastered. That's not much mastery at all.
Well, Bill Elliott is doing a good job, and I think he knows he's comfortably out in front of the people. He's going to take care of that car. He's smart enough to know he has a way to go. Harry Gant just kissed the wall running real high, the same line that Earnhardt's running in, and it's getting close, it's getting loose.
And well, the guys are having to really keep their hammer down. Like I said, right now you can't afford to get behind at this point in the race. You've got to run the car as hard as it possibly will go. That means running high here today. If you run high, you take your chances of kissing that wall.
389 laps have been run thus far in this event. It has been slowed by 7 caution periods. None of them more serious than the Crispin incident, when he hit really hard out turn number 2.
Terry Labonte is able to fend off another time as they're about to put a lap on the Folgers car, Benny Parsons. There is Labonte still holding second position by a tad over car number three, Dale Earnhardt. Morgan Shepherd back there in fourth and in fifth, Walker. And those cars running a cluster, 5 6/10 of a second back from the leader, Bill Elliott's number nine.
And don't leave Kyle out. He's right there behind Darrell, too. So, I mean, they're all in there.
Grand battle. And for the moment, they're willing to let it lie just as it is. There will be, what, one more stop, gentlemen? One more time on pit road?
I would think so. One more probably would get the job done.
I think the other thing is that Dale Earnhardt, he ran everybody down. He's not sitting behind Terry Labonte because he wants to. He's driving just as hard as he ever has. Terry's just doing a heck of a job. His car's at the dead bottom of the racetrack. Dale's at the very top, and the bottom is the shortest way around if your car's working.
100 laps to go here this afternoon to decide it all in the $400,000 AC Delco 500 being contested by seven drivers for the win. We'll be with you for the finish.
Promotional fee and consideration paid by Mr. Goodwrench and General Motors Parts. No one knows your GM car better than Mr. Goodwrench. No one. And by Superflow Motor Oils from Exxon. Want your engine to last? Go with the flow. Go with Superflow.
A record crowd is enjoying the AC Delco 500. You're enjoying it here on the Superstation WTBS today. Alongside is Lake Speed and John Hayes on pit road, Pat Patterson and Jerry Garrett, Dave Despain in the STP Pit Center. I'm Ken Squire, and the action is incredible. There's the man that leads, car number nine, Bill Elliott in front. And we'll take a look at the interval with 94 laps remaining in the event. Back to the second place contest, which is a tight one. One more stop expected in the race for fuel and tires here. And there you see the leader, and now you see the second place cars running side by side. It's about 4 8/10 of a second. So about a second has gone away from that lead. Second place is Terry Labonte. Third is Earnhardt. And fourth, that green Buick of Morgan Shepherd. With fifth, Waltrip. Sixth, Petty. Seventh, Baker in the lead lap. There's the battle for second place. Terry Labonte and Dale Earnhardt. We were talking earlier about this great record of consistency, this phenomenal record out of only one race this year. John, do you remember who has the overall record for consecutive finishes in Winston Cup racing?
Huh? Yeah,
the old expert?
I think Earnhardt's probably wimpy on that. I think it was Herman Bean. He probably finished close to 100 races.
Oh, you're absolutely right. The Turtle, Herman Bean, had 84.
Okay, I knew Herman was strong.
He was usually several laps down, but
he had a kind of Bean's Baxter, one of those.
Yeah. Not one of the all-time leaders up in front, but he certainly can finish a lot of races.
Well, you have to have your priorities and live within your limits. It's been my motto all my life.
Herman Bean, the Turtle. Now, as we watch the battle continuing for second place, here's Terry Labonte. Right with him, Dale Earnhardt. On the outside again. Look at Earnhardt use up that outside line. Doesn't, no margin for error there.
He's scared that wall to death today, I'm sure.
You're right, Dave.
Listen, I have a question for Dave Despain, because I can tell he's well-educated and is probably talking down to us boys from the Mill Hill, but how do you spell oppression, or that big old fancy word? If you can spell it, you can use it. You can't use it, you can't spell it.
I'm going to take a chance on it, Scotty. I think it's P-R-E-S-C-I-E-N-T, but I actually don't have a clue.
No, it's C-I-A-N-T. You flunk. Don't use the word anymore.
Here's Earnhardt around once again into second spot. Dale Earnhardt picking up a spot on Terry Labonte, using it outside, methodically working his way along. And as Lake Speed pointed out, scaring that wall to pieces every time he comes through there. That's the Gant line. That's the Shepherd line right up there, right on the outside. And now notice that number 11 is fading up there and trying that spot. Morgan Shepherd lies just behind them. Waltrip next. Kyle Petty is closing up a little in his quest to take the fifth position from Darrell Waltrip. Here on TBS, Turner Broadcasting, our next live race. We'll be with you at Riverside, California, Sunday, November 8th. And hope you'll be here to enjoy the action from Riverside, California's nine-turn road course. There's number 21, Kyle Petty. He is running sixth. Let's get back and just see the interval to the man in front of him. Number 17, there he is, Darrell Waltrip. And he has him in view, and he's trying to reel him in here.
You notice right now the glistening on the pavement as the guys are going into the first turn. That sun is starting to really give them fits when they're looking into the windshield down there.
What does it do to you?
It blinds you is what it does, because the sand pits the windshield and a little oil and grease gets in. And even when they wipe the windshield, they can't get it out of the pits. So it just gets to be a haze. And then as you get in there, it's just a blinding haze.
Well, what do you do for it?
You just judge where the corner is and watch the other cars in front of you and use them as to judge off of going in the corner.
Literally the old dirt track style when you used to get
absolutely
up and count to five and turn left.
But that, just gauge off the guys and hope there's nothing on the track, because if there is, you'll never see it.
Here's Pat Patterson on pit row.
Well, the story in the leader's pit, Tim Squire, is going to be tires. Now, we have about 100 laps left. They're planning on pitting on about 425. This is one set of tires, sticker tires, that remains. There's another set of tires over on the wall. Now, when they come in on lap 425, of course, they'll put sticker tires back on the car. They have one set of tires left. Therefore, if we have a couple of caution flags this last 100 laps, Elliott could be out of sticker tires and be forced to finish the race on the used tires.
Well, Pat, you can run over to Richard Childress and tell him that Bill needs some help with his tires, because Richard's got a bunch, and I'm sure he'd like for Bill to have some of them. That's the only fair thing to do, an honorable thing to do, and I know this is an honorable, fair sport.
Oh, sure. Let's take a look now at the interval between first and second. Here's Elliott in front, and I don't think there's any question that Earnhardt is really taking a pretty good bite out of this lead. Remember, it was 5 seconds. We had a report of 3.6. There you see the car number 9, and up on the high side, that yellow and blue car, that's 2 9/10 seconds on the old watch. So paring down that lead, that is Earnhardt coming on strong here at the end of the race.
The pressure's on right now. If this thing were to run green, he's got a lot of real estate to catch up before he can even get up there to fight him over it.
Meanwhile, Morgan Shepherd runs in that fourth position. Eli's just a few seconds back, and he's in very good shape. Remember, he's getting great range on that Buick. He almost made a lap on the field the last time when they all had to pit. He stayed out there in the Kenny Bernstein car and kept on coming on. Morgan Shepherd, can you govern the amount of tire spin to get off these turns on this track?
You get quite a bit here. I know, like when we get into Saw Rider down in the middle of 3 and 4, coming up off the corner, the car spins quite a bit coming up out of the corner, and that's something you've got to try to overcome, because eventually you'll burn the tires off of it. But this track is a little bit like a dirt track. You get off into one, and it'll hang out quite a bit there also.
Eli's about 5.5 seconds back from the leader, Elliott. And it's now just 2 seconds between this man, Bill Elliott in number 9, and Dale Earnhardt in number 3. Incidentally, for a lot of race fans in the Southeast, Melling Racing is going to have an open house for charity up there in Dawsonville, Georgia, November 14th and 15th. If you'd like to come by and see a great racing shop, that opportunity is available to folks. If you're traveling around America at this time of the year and you're looking for something to do on November 14th and 15th, it's one of the most modern and super shops in the country. And it's up there in Dawsonville, Georgia. Beautiful country, just a little south of Delmonica. Part of the old country of Georgia.
Oh, it's beautiful there. And you'll be impressed with the shop, but you just won't believe what they've accomplished out of there.
Here's Pat Patterson on pit road.
Well, Johnny Hayes, we wanted to get the story here. We wanted to find out if, in fact, Richard will sell some tires.
We got a crash in turn two.
Earnhardt.
We got a serious trouble. It is Earnhardt. Earnhardt has just crashed in turn two. He spun. He took the wall. Some folks are very enthusiastic about it. Some of them are absolutely disappointed. You're either one way or the other on this man. Earnhardt.
The car is moving again on the back stretch. He keeps on going around. He will not lose a lap.
He's back to speed. He will not lose a lap.
The car is abused. It apparently touched the outside of the wall.
He was really, really pressing down, trying to close that gap up, and of course he had closed it up.
All right, now here we'll have a little look at what happened. I don't know if we have it all, but we have some of it. By himself, I think he grazed the outside wall, and away it went. Earnhardt with a miscue here in turn number three, and it may cost him a shot at winning this thing.
I don't think so. I tell you, he was making up 0.2 seconds a lap, and he was really coming, and he didn't do any damage. I think he'll throw some of Richard's new tires on there and be right back at you.
Pat Patterson is in his pit, and let's get a damage report on car number three as it comes in here. It's on the pit road, and I think he's abused a little bit of the right rear on the car. It may be jammed, maybe not. You see it pulling down there. Here's Pat.
Well, Ken, looked on the right side of the car, did not look that damaged at all. If in fact he got much damage, it was maybe just bent into the right rear fender just a little bit. The team is trying to pull some of the sheet metal back away from the front right tire as well as from the rear tire. Earnhardt managed to stay, and now we got the Jackman fell right in front of the car as they're going to try to change four tires. We'll take a look from the rear of the car so we get a little bit better shot at damage report for you.
Laps complete, 415. 415 complete of the 492 that will make the distance of 500 miles here at Rockingham. As Rockingham claims another victim, the wall, not being intimidated by Dale Earnhardt, reached out and grabbed him in turn number two, and it may have turned the entire complexion of this race. We'll be back with more Flag to Flag live coverage on the Superstation in a moment.
We're back at the North Carolina Motor Speedway. Dale Earnhardt has brought the car in three times after being involved in an altercation. They set the tow in on the car. Apparently, they won't know for sure how much damage is done until the car actually gets back up to speed. They have had the car in three times. Let's go further down the pit road to my partner, Gary Jarrett.
Well, if you think about this, Pat, this may be one of the best things that Earnhardt could have done. If he hasn't hurt his car too bad, what he's done is he's looped it around but been able to stay on the lead lap himself. He's got plenty of tires to change to. He's now forced all his competition to come in and put on their last set. They've played their last card. This is it.
As they line up for the restart, it will be car number 11. Last cards being played by all those teams now. Car number 11, Waltrip takes the lead. Number 11, Labonte takes the lead. Waltrip will be in second in 17. Then the 9 of Elliott in third. It'll be Morgan Shepherd fourth, Kyle Petty in fifth, Buddy Baker in sixth. Like, do you think that Labonte can hold them off from here?
I think it's all just depends on this last setup here. If this is the last one, we may have several more last ones before this day's over. It's just, each one of these cars has shown the capacity to run out front. We're just going to see what they got now.
As they zip into turn number one, Labonte in front. Three-car length advantage over the number 17, which is Waltrip.
Waltrip's had a great day. He's driven a smart race, as he always has, and he always seems to look. He's going for the lead. He's trying to go high. Waltrip always, when you get to the end of the race, you say, gosh, I didn't realize, and here he is right up front. I would not count Darrell Waltrip out. Jeff Hammond has been a great assistance to that program.
I agree with that 100%, because, you know, in the last season where Darrell was winning all the races, it was that same story over and over again. Where'd he come from? Out of nowhere. And then all of a sudden, he was there winning the race.
Car number 17, Waltrip closes on Terry Labonte. Car that he drove a year ago. Then in that third spot, here comes Bill Elliott down on the inside. No, not this time.
At this point right now, it appears that Terry's car may be holding up both Darrell and Bill,
which isn't a bad deal at all. If he can hold it for a few laps, let them wear down some rubber. I don't believe, though, he can keep that up for long. It's a fairly wide area going down right there in turn three. And he's done. There's Elliott trying the high side right now, taking a look from a little higher vantage point.
Two very aggressive getting drivers right behind him, too.
Morgan Shepherd's real happy about that if they are holding him up, because he's coming up quick and we're getting ready to have a four-car battle.
Yes, and Morgan Shepherd is back almost a full second, half second from these three.
And he needs that opportunity.
Give you an interval right now here shortly. Show you the difference between the front three, Morgan Shepherd in fourth, Kyle Petty in fifth, Buddy Baker in sixth, Earnhardt still running in seventh. And Earnhardt isn't off the pace that much after that altercation in turn two. There's Morgan Shepherd. He's still very much in this race. And as those front three continue their own vendetta, he forges toward the front, trying to close in on that trio. This has been an incredible race this afternoon. It has had 30 lead changes among 10 drivers. Among 10 drivers, 13 of the original 42 starters have retired. And Elliott looks inside, down the main straightaway. Everybody on their feet as this trio brings them up there once again. The crowd will be as exhausted as the drivers when this one's over. Elliott to the inside, creeping, crawling, moving along the inside bottom, moving on car number 17, and he has it. It's Bill Elliott in the second, trying for two in a row. One at Charlotte 2 weeks back. Now, pursues Labonte.
Again, strategy comes in here, Ken. These top cars up there, let's don't waste our tires. Let's don't burn them up, heat them up. Let's try to be here to save. That's kind of driver Darrell Waltrip is. He's smart. He'll hopefully, his car's good enough, he can sit there and not use the tires up.
Waltrip, so far for season, has finally turned around, and his once troubled team is now one big happy family. Dave Despain has that story.
For 1987, engine wizard Waddell Wilson joined forces with Darrell Waltrip to form what was supposed to be a stock car superpower. Instead, the team floundered. So at mid-year, Darrell enticed his crew chief from the Junior Johnson era, Jeff Hammond, on the right, to come on board.
He didn't maybe know exactly what he was getting into. It's like I told him the day that he decided to come to work for us. I said, oh, buddy, you have just made a career move. It may be the end of your career, but you have just made a career move.
Waltrip's warning reflected the wall of tension that he and Wilson had built between them.
I view our situation as a marriage. We dated for a while, and then we got married, and we found out we couldn't live together.
Waddell's not a hard guy to understand. You know, he's a perfectionist, and so is Darrell. Maybe that's where they had a little bit more of a different of a situation or a different of opinion, because two different ideas of perfection, you might say.
He could step in between Waddell and I and say, well, here's what Darrell thinks, and Waddell say, well, here's what I think. We couldn't tell each other, but we could tell somebody else, and it's made a big difference. It's helped the team a lot.
It's like I told him whenever I went in there. I said, hey, you know, I'm not no Houdini, and I never probably ever will be. I'm a mechanic, and that's what I'm always going to be, and I just want to try to get along with the guys in the team and then still do my job.
With the humble Hammond back at his side, Darrell finally won at Martinsville, Virginia, and he's looking toward the future.
We'll get rid of a few chiefs, and there'll just be me and Jeff and the Indians, the Marines. We got a lot of general Marines.
He needs some more Marines right now. He's falling back. Meanwhile, up in front, Bill Elliott is closing on Terry Labonte. Here he is coming to the outside. Again, Chevy number 11, Ford number 9, as we get to the final moments of this AC Delco 500. And back to the inside moves car number 9, Elliott. Looks down in there, so steady, so relentless. His pursuit is just always so even. He doesn't seem to raise a hair as he darts and dives and dodges among these lapped automobiles. Back straight away another time. He closes in again. And here comes Waltrip back another time. It's going to be some finish here today on the Superstation. TBS bringing you the AC Delco 500 to the inside. Elliott creeping back in there another time.
That's a driver that's got a lot of confidence in his race car, and I think it's showing right now. He's not trying to press the situation. He just wants to kind of see if he can't irritate Terry into getting in the position where he can just drive by clean.
I would like to say one thing about the Darrell Waltrip interview concerning Waddell Wilson. Waddell Wilson is one of the most gifted engine builders in the history of the sport, and still is. And I personally witnessed a man give him a blank check and said, you fill it out, Waddell, and come to work for me. But he made a commitment to Rick Hendricks and the operation, and that's where he's going to stay. And I really respect Waddell Wilson for the way he handled that.
He is some kind of human being. Anybody that's seen him back in the Cayley Arbor days, even before that, he started out with Bobby Allison down in Hialeah in Florida. And he's always been just a cut above, a really, you know, it sounds like such a cliche, but such a real superhuman being. Now, there's Earnhardt back there in third, and he looks like he may, back in fifth, sixth, in the number three car. Earnhardt back in that sixth position in number three, and trying to find Kyle Petty, the champion, won the title this afternoon, but right now looking up from under. And the championship doesn't mean a thing to him right now.
I don't think that he's losing any ground right now, the leader, because he was started back in the field there pretty thick. It appears that maybe now he's kind of getting settled into the new feel that the car's got. Obviously, the toe end got knocked out. When that happens, the car just picks up a little different feel. The wheel's not usually in the same position it's been in for
the majority of the race, and you just have to kind of get used to that new horse that's under you.
He's back about 4.5 seconds, so perhaps we can get that interval between these people. These two running for the lead, Labonte and Elliott, then back to the 17 running in third. There he is, Waltrip, and then in fourth, we could go back a little further, you'll find Morgan Shepherd. Morgan Shepherd coming along right there in fourth. Then in fifth, a little further back would be Kyle Petty on the racetrack. There he is. And in sixth would be the Earnhardt car, the number three. There he is. And that gives you an idea of what the crowd is seeing here on those front six automobiles. Buddy Baker completes the lap in seventh place with his Oldsmobile. That battle for the lead. Looks like Elliott, is he waiting? Or do you think that that's all he has to offer right now?
I really think the man is very confident in his race car. Terry's running real good right now, too. There's no sense in pressing on a slick track and getting yourself in trouble. The checkered flag's not in the next few laps. He's sitting there waiting for a golden opportunity to drive by.
And historically, Bill Elliott has done this exact thing. He's comfortable. He doesn't want to use the tires up. He doesn't know if it's going to go green all the way. He has done this before. If he could drive right by and not be contested, it would be no problem. But he is not going to force an issue until it's time to force that issue.
And there's another side to that story, too. When he's got his nose stuck up underneath the back end of Terry's car like that, I'm going to tell you what, it loosens up Terry's car and tends to heat Terry's tires up more. He can sit there and worry him to death until he gets Terry running where he can't go through the corner the way he is now.
Benny Parsons giving us these pictures from further back in the field in the Folgers car number 35 with our Superflow Motor Oil's in-car camera back there in 26th position. Now let's go, that was in the 24th position. Here's car number 26, Morgan Shepherd, who continues in fourth, and Jerry Garrett can update us on that car.
Well, here's how desperate they are down at Morgan Shepherd's pit to come up with a set of tires that they could use on their right side if they get another shot to put some on. This is a set that they had on the outside for about three laps earlier in the race. They got an immediate caution. They came in and took these off. What he's peeling off here now is some buildup that it got from running under caution. If they get these things cleaned off, they think they might just perform like almost two tires. I don't know if it'll work or not, but Larry McReynolds, the crew chief on this team, has been selected the mechanic of the race for his efforts like this.
Kyle Petty closing. Petty closing in on Morgan Shepherd. 4-4. Running a lower line with the Wood Brothers car. And there goes Elliott looking at the lead. Greg Sachs right in front of him has to back off one more time. You know, the Wood Brothers have won this race four times, trying for their fifth win today with Kyle. And look at this group up in front. Trio running for first place down into turn one. That is some kind of racing. Getting very dark down there in the shadow of that first and second turn coming off four. You're just blinded all the way down this main straightaway. Here's Kyle Petty closing on Morgan Shepherd. Battle continuing for fourth. Where do you want to be late in this race, Kyle?
Late in the race, I want to already be checked out and gone. You know, that's pretty much the way you want to do here. You know, they've had close racing here, and they've had close racing in the past. But most of the time, it comes down to there's always a caution within the last 25 or 30 laps, and then that turns into a 25 or 30 lap sprint race between two or three cars. And, you know, that seems to be the way it's always been in the past. So late in the race, you just want to still be in the lead lap and be up there and hopefully catch a caution at the end. And, you know, if you're leading, you don't want a caution. But if you can't catch a caution, you want to catch a caution, then just go from there.
Here's Kyle just exerting a little more pressure here as he tries to close in. And Earnhardt is 3.7 seconds back from the leader. There are the leaders. When I say leader, I should say leaders. That's Labonte and Elliott continuing their slugfest up in front. But just behind them is Waltrip in third, then that Morgan Shepherd-Kyle Petty duel, and Earnhardt is closing all the time, moving in on Kyle Petty in the 21 and Morgan Shepherd. Great racing, late in the going. It's going to be a dramatic finish no matter what, unless something untoward happens right in here.
Now, I may be a little bit wrong on my prediction there with Bill, too. I noticed the last lap or two, it appears that he's maybe searching a little bit. He's starting to run a little different line than Terry instead of just dogging him like he was. He may be doing all he can do.
Well, there's Waltrip closing in again. Those three cars continue their dice for the lead. Then Morgan Shepherd continues to pull up. Kyle Petty and Earnhardt. Back to the bottom of the racetrack, the number 17.
Waltrip, three-time Winston Cup champion, takes a shot at the inside. Two-time winner here on this track. Then pulls back in behind number nine, Bill Elliott, as they put a lap on his brother, Mike Waltrip.
Can you believe we've run 446 laps, and these cars, you could throw a blanket over them? Blake and I talked earlier about how close this racing is today and how many good teams, and I think probably at a racetrack like this, this is one of the best examples I've ever seen.
And it's on one of the most grueling tracks, one of the hardest tracks physically on the driver and also on the equipment to finish. And yet, here we are. He's at the end of the race, like we said, and they're all over each other.
Here's Pat Patterson.
Terry Labonte has two sets of right side tires left up in Junior Johnson's pit. Now that's four tires, don't get confused, not two sets of four, but two sets of two tires. Dale Earnhardt, meanwhile, has plenty of tires left. On down the road there at the number nine pit, they only have one set of right side sticker tires left. So Lake, I guess it's going to turn out to be a battle of the tires if we get another caution flag and don't go the rest of the way green. Back up to Dave DeSpain.
As we watch this lead battle, we started the show talking about the $550,000 that Dale Earnhardt won just by starting this race and clinching the championship. What we're watching at the head of this field would be the second, third, and fourth ranked cars in the Winston Cup standing, and we ain't talking peanuts. $485,000 in point fund money are at stake among those drivers. The two you see right there, number 11 Terry Labonte and number 9 Bill Elliott, are racing for second place in the ranking. Labonte is trying to overtake Elliott for that position. Right behind them, Waltrip, currently fourth ranked in the category. Winston Cup Racing is a big buck deal, and Dale Earnhardt, the big money winner, is gaining on it.
About 43 miles left to run here. Just a little over 43 miles. This track's slightly bigger than 1 mile. And here is this battle for the lead. Terry Labonte and Bill Elliott, both former winners, each have won at one time, are slugging it out here for first place. And as they do, Darrell Waltrip watches, perched in third spot. Behind them comes Morgan Shepherd in fourth, Kyle Petty fifth, Earnhardt in sixth. Back straightaway around some of the slower traffic on the move. Number three, Earnhardt, is still very much in this, even though he spun, even though he's banged up the back of the car a little. Looks like he has found a way around, and he's still closing up on 21, Kyle Petty.
It looks like he's just found a spurt of energy there all of a sudden, because it just hard to seem like it closed on the front ones there just in the last few laps dramatically.
Well, it was like 5 seconds. It's back down toward 3.5. We'll get that interval again between those cars running in the front five positions. There are the leaders, numbers 11 and 9, Labonte and Elliott. There you see the number 17, Waltrip in the third spot. In fourth, the green car, Morgan Shepherd. In fifth, that 21 car. And there's sixth, number three. Further back, and not that far back, just 2 seconds back from number three, is Buddy Baker's Oldsmobile, number 88. He's still in that race.
Buddy's had an outstanding day in his Oldsmobile. He really has done a great job.
Meanwhile, battle for the lead goes into turn number four. There's Buddy Baker, and up in front. Look at this battle for the lead. Sneaking down to the inside. Bill Elliott ready to try to make a move. Terry Labonte trying to fight him off. Into turn one, Waltrip dips down. And fading number 11 up the bank. Car number nine making a great move. It's Elliott going out in front still another time. The 31st lead change among 10 drivers in the race.
Now we'll see if Elliott pulls off and if he was just riding and Terry was holding him up. We'll get this answered real quickly.
Here he is down at a turn number one, and he does draw away by about three car lengths.
It may very well be that the guys in his pits told him on the radio that Mr. Earnhardt is on the way again. You best get gone if you don't go.
I'll guarantee you that's exactly what happened.
That Waltrip is coming on, so get out and get going.
Earnhardt's coming on.
Earnhardt's the one that's coming
on. He's coming
in. He's already passed Kyle. He's fifth now and closing fast.
There he is up on the high side in turn three.
He's just now got comfortable enough with his car to start running back up there on that wall.
Well, let's check the number of laps now. It is 492 total. Showing 455 complete. Think he's got time, Earnhardt, to come all the way back into this thing?
thing we need to remember about Dale Earnhardt, actually two things. He came from three laps behind to win at Charlotte earlier this year. He's gained a full second off the interval there on those leaders. He's reeled them in by a full second. Key here is that he's learned how to drive a different race car. After he crashed it into the wall, it just drives differently. Johnny Hayes talked about it. Lake Speed talked about it. He took a few laps, figured out what was happening, stood right back on the gas, and went right back after them. The final point I want to make is that these race cars all run twice a year at each track. On three previous racetracks this year, Richmond, Darlington, and Bristol, Earnhardt has swept. He won both races on that racetrack. Here, if he can do it, he'll have his fourth sweep of the season. It would be back-to-back wins at Rockingham for Dale Earnhardt. And one last point. Why would this guy, who won $550,000 today, go out, bash into the wall, drive the wheels off the car, trying so hard to win the race when he's already got the championship? There's one thing left for Dale Earnhardt to do this season. The all-time record for the modern-day record for single-season victories is 13 by Richard Petty. If he can win two, this year he can tie the record. If he can win it all, he's the new record holder.
Waltrip on the inside, working against Terry Labonte, as Earnhardt tries to close on that record. He's moving in on Morgan Shepherd, just a few car lengths back from this pair, running in the second position. And Elliott is moving away as we get into the final moments of the race. Elliott, as we saw him at Charlotte just 2 weeks ago, is just pulling rank here and drawing away from the rest of the field.
Well, I think Elliott's played his game just like he does so well. I think he rode, took care of his car, and he probably got the word Earnhardt's coming, and I think he threw it in, and he's gone away. So I'm saying now, if everything stays green, they're going to have trouble running down. Earnhardt has a shot at the other cars.
And as we see here, that big interval, it continues to develop for Elliott. The battle is right here in second place, and it may get even more intense as trying to close in on them is Shepherd and Earnhardt running in the fourth and fifth positions. And you can see what Dale Earnhardt has done. He was better than 50, 60 car lengths down 25 laps ago. And here's Earnhardt right up on Morgan Shepherd. This is the contest for fourth.
Again, remember, these are two pit bulls, so you have to be real careful around them. There won't be any pushing and shoving here. It'll be hopefully a good clean pass.
This chick can't time here for too very long too, so they're not gonna be playing. You can't wait.
Down to the inside, trying to move in and then ducking back in is car number three, Earnhardt. And again, he looks to the inside, down here in turn number one. That Buick doesn't want to stay on the bottom of the racetrack, and Earnhardt finds the hole. They come out even. Earnhardt with plenty of room. It's a little less room as he goes into turn number one, but he's there. And Earnhardt picks up fourth position. Shepherd falls to fifth.
Earnhardt's car works good low and high. You saw that pass there. He dove right under it low.
The thing that I was just hit me just before that, his car may be working better right now than it was prior to him wrecking.
29 laps left this time by. 29 to go. Earnhardt now goes on a hunt, searching for these two men. Terry Labonte in number 11, Darrell Waltrip in 17. Getting down toward the finish here this afternoon of the AC Delco 500. As Bill Elliott leads, Terry Labonte is second, Darrell Waltrip third, and Dale Earnhardt is fourth. It is a war for second place. Waltrip just waltzed to the inside on Labonte, and Labonte would not give ground. They traded paint. Again, Labonte is back to second. Waltrip is in third, but closing all the time from fourth. There you see it, the yellow and blue car. Here comes Earnhardt with a tremendous run late in the going here. Directly in the sun, down the main straightaway. Closes up. There's no question that Earnhardt is on the warpath. Here he comes. There is Benny Parsons' car, and you can see him coming up into that sun and see the restriction from the visibility. How tough is the afternoon sun out here, Benny Parsons?
It is a problem because going down, the sun sitting in the west, going down the front straightaway, you're literally driving right into the sun. And you get a little bit of oil, a little bit of dust on the windshield, which makes visibility tough anyway. And that sun, you just literally have to look over your shoulder at the racetrack. And when you see the apron down there, that means you got to turn.
That's the story from Benny Parsons, now running in 16th position. The situation that all of them are facing here as this battle continues. Here is Earnhardt still using that high line, closing another time on Waltrip in third, Labonte in second. Elliott scooting away from the field now as he surges into what should be his fifth victory. But there are no shoulds in motorsport, and there's still a distance to be run here this afternoon. 471 of 492 laps are now complete. Here's Pat Patterson.
Richard Childress, the car owner for Dale Earnhardt. You guys have won a championship today, and you're really trying hard to win a race. What's happening on the race car, Richard?
Well, you know, we got the front end knocked a little bit out of line, but Kirk got it back pretty good. We're still trying to do our best.
Can you win this thing?
No, we ain't give up yet. Bill's awful strong. He's been strong all day.
Ken?
Bill has been strong all day, and he kept it in reserve. He didn't go out there and make a big exhibition of himself in the early going. He just stayed back and waited, and then when it counted, he began to come on. And it looks like the old siren in Dawsonville, Georgia, may get another workout. As they come out of turn number four, Earnhardt getting a little workout on car number three, stuffs that Chevy at the inside and closes up on Waltrip another time. And no question, the word has been given to those men in second and third. Labonte, 11, 17 Waltrip, that here he comes. And one of the things that he does do is he intimidates people. He makes you look out the back.
Well, let's don't write this race off yet. One caution makes a whole new ball game, new tires, bounces everybody up. And these are usually the times when you have to get aggressive and go for it. You do swap paint, get together, and that caution comes out. So I think we're going to have a shootout all the way.
Well, it looks good to me anyway. I mean, you've got cars out there, one guy's away, but the rest of these guys right here for second place are digging. They are really working on each other hard.
Waltrip continuing to worry. Car number 11, Labonte, as Earnhardt just stays very high and looks them over. But an interesting thing is developing just behind Earnhardt, and that is that car number 7, who's running back a few laps, is willing to run up there with them, and he's staying with those front runners. If he wants to go up there and play and gets in the middle of something, that could get real interesting. That's Alan Kowicki in number 7, who's running as stout as anyone out here at the present time.
Well, Earnhardt scares me to death. He shoots up that corner so fast, and here he comes. And I tell you, these people are getting after each other. He's on the ragged edge.
Dale Earnhardt, where do you want to be in those last two laps?
Ran up front all day, you feel pretty good. You sort of just struggle to stay alone because you had trouble when you're a couple laps down. It's rough on you, but you know, I think I can make it through no trouble. Bobby Allison, I think, have a little bit of trouble making it. He tires out. He's the oldest he is.
Bobby Allison was standing right behind him, and he was doing a little psych job there on Allison. Didn't buy any of it. Here he is, and he must be feeling very chipper right now. All spruced up as he moves around Waltrip and takes over third place and begins to zero in now on the second position of Terry Labonte. Number 11, Labonte in the red and white car. Then comes Earnhardt, followed by Waltrip. Maintaining fifth is Shepherd, sixth Kyle Petty, seventh is Buddy Baker, all in the lead lap.
Earnhardt told me recently when he grows up, he'd like to be like A.J. Foyt. Well, I think he's grown up, and I'd say they just about the same.
Tell you what, right then, that car is pretty loose. He's driving it awful hard. And he came off the fourth turn that time. The car at the back end was out from under.
And he does not lift. Did you notice? He will not lift. He just keeps on going and straightens back out. He's a great dirt track racer. Maybe we should put him in the World Outlaws.
Here he is.
They don't want to see
him. Watch him here, because this is right where he had trouble before and had to make that correction. Now, that's where you see the experience. Steve Christman made the correction, and without the experience of an Earnhardt, he got in trouble. Earnhardt just picked it up as if it meant absolutely nothing with this 3,500-pound car. We're setting the interval once more for you. Here's Bill Elliott in the lead in number 9, trying to stretch that car to the finish from here. Jeff Bodine just in front of him. Jeff is 8th overall in the race. 9th is Phil Parsons. 10th is Joe Ruttman. Woo! Moving around Buddy Arrington. Coming up to the outside Labonte there. Wild moves out here. 11th Sterling Marlin, 12th is Ginn. As you look back now, we're checking this interval. There you see 2nd, then 3rd, the number 3 car. In 4th, the number 17. And it might be worth it for just a second to check in on Morgan Shepherd here behind the 17 and see what position he is in on the racetrack. There's that battle, and it continues to be a doozy. Maybe we better stay right here. Earnhardt looks like he wants to go on Terry Labonte. Drives to the bottom of the racetrack, making his move into turn 1. Terry with a high line, and here comes Earnhardt.
trying for second spot. Is he going to get it? Labonte trying hard on the outside to come back. Now remember, when they come to the corner, then three, Earnhardt has liked the outside of the racetrack a ton. He's run right up there. Can he stay on the bottom?
Well, he sure did. Terry took it on the bottom and shot up just a little bit to give Dale a little more room, but he's not giving him an inch. He's going to race him door to door, and he jumps him a little bit right there, and he pulls up.
And it's Labonte going back around Earnhardt, Lake Speed.
On that last, next to the last half going in, when Dale pulled on the inside of Terry, he literally had to slide the car into the corner. And I think that time when he went back in, Terry pressed him on in hard. He wasn't going to take that chance twice.
Now, see, he tried the outside. That high line, which he has enjoyed. Ooh, and he had to cut it a little there. That car wanted to eat up some of the wall.
Absolutely, but, you know, when he drove that car in the first turn, he just wanted to get on under Terry, but their back end just would not stay. And it was one of those deals where you just had to slide the car. Four-wheel drifted. You talk about dirt tracking. He was dirt tracking that thing into the corner.
With nine to go, Kowicki makes himself known up in there. He's running many laps down. Had trouble in the mid-going of the race, but he certainly made a great comeback here. Alan Kowicki, he is not being shown in the top 16. He had in some of those rundowns for you. I wonder if Earnhardt is going to get another shot at Terry Labonte. He's tried him on the inside. He's tried him on the outside.
Well, I can assure you he will get another shot at him. He's not going to use those tires up.
Let's go back up to the leader. Here's Bill Elliott in the number 9 car. Under 10 laps to go. I think 7 laps right here. Make the margin to victory. And Bill Elliott, who's won $1,129,000 this year. His average for the race is very slow. It's down around 117 miles an hour, well off the record. But he's turning very good laps late in the going in this one-mile facility. Labonte stays second, Earnhardt in third, and he may have that car in a leaning rest position for just a moment.
I think they do that. They'll try pass and pass. Now, heat the tires up, let them rest, see his car kick sideways. He's driving the heck out of it, but now he don't want to heat those tires up, and now he's ready to go again.
Sideways down into one. You can see it skittering just a little. He gets the nose down underneath. This is for second place. Earnhardt on the bottom. Does he have him? We'll see when we get to turn three. Nobody lifts. Flat on the floorboard. Both throttles. And as they go in there, Earnhardt gets the edge. He tries to move his man up a little and does so. And as he makes him pull up just a little, it is Earnhardt into second.
Can you see Earnhardt sawing that steering wheel? Looking at him, folks, he is just sawing that thing to make it get by, and he sure did.
Final moments. Labonte falling back. Waltrip has a shot at him. Darrell Waltrip ready to make that run to see if he can get third as Bill Elliott continues to draw away. Now look at Elliott in the number 9. So easy, so smooth, so consistently strong, particularly in the last part of the season. It's a replay of the Charlotte Oakwood Homes 500 from 2 weeks ago. And now there's the interval between car number 9, your leader, and the second place man in the event as they come out of turn 4. Dale Earnhardt pulling up in there. Big interval. Back to that second place man. Rusty Wallace going another lap down. He's running 12th in the field. Elliott leading by 6 3/10 of a second as we get ready to decide it here in this 400,000 plus race. Lion's share looks like it's headed for Dawsonville, Georgia. And at Gordon Perkel's pool hall, they're beginning to gather for the festivities.
And this is the time that everybody in Bill Elliott's pit and Bill Elliott are real nervous. They're just saying, hey, hold together. I hope we have enough gas. Everything go. Let's get this thing over and go home.
Elliott in front. Now look at 17 Waltrip in there. And look at Kowicki staying right up there showing his colors. What a fighter he is.
I'll tell you what, Darrell Waltrip right now is smelling blood too, I think. He made a good stab at the inside of Terry going into one right there. It's about the same move that Dale had done.
White flag. White flag is out. Last lap is underway, and here they come in the charge. It is Waltrip around the outside, moving by Terry Labonte with one to go. Labonte coming back. This is your battle. Elliott will take it home. He'll win by 6 or 7 seconds. The battle is for second place. It is the battle for third. There it is, 17-11. Earnhardt will come in second. The battle will be for third at the line. Coming back to the strike. Number 9 is going to win it. Checkered flag is out. It'll be number 3 in second. And at the line, Waltrip will come home third. about a car and a half length in front of Terry Labonte when they crossed the stripe.
One of the key things that happened there is Labonte got together with the 27 car, Rusty Wallace. There wasn't enough room. Darrell was able to go around on the outside and just got caught in one of those situations.
So car number 9 has won his fifth race of 1987. Bill Elliott, victorious here today. Dale Earnhardt pulling up to congratulate him. Both million-dollar drivers here in 1987. We'll be back with more from the AC Delco 500 in a moment. Bill Elliott of Dawsonville, Georgia, reigns supreme the second time a Harry Melling team has won here at The Rock. North Carolina Motor Speedway, clambering out of his car. Elliott, ecstatic, his crew, his brothers, his family all gathered around him down there, and let's go to victory lane.
Bill, fifth victory this year. Is this the toughest one?
Well, I believe it. You know, you run all day long, and it's just one of those days. I've got a good friend, Joe, watching back in Nashville. I know you watch him, so this one's for you.
Didn't seem like your car ran as good early as it did late. Is that true?
Well, I kept changing the way I was driving a car, and I finally hit on something, and man, the thing would go. And we kept working with the car, and finally the thing just hooked up. Man, I couldn't do nothing wrong.
Now, before that last caution period, it seemed like Earnhardt was catching up to you. Could you see that? Could you get the intervals on those?
Well, see, the problem was when Rudd blew up, he put oil all over my windshield, and I couldn't see anything. I couldn't even see how to get in the first turn.
When the sun came out, you were just hanging on.
I couldn't see anything, and I knew I was losing a lot of time to him, which I knew he was running good anyway.
But once you got the windshield cleaned off, though, and got that last set of tires, that must have been a good set.
Well, Labonte ran awful good there for a long time, and I didn't know if I was ever going to get by him. Finally, his car got to getting a little loose up off the corner, and I said, boy, I got him now. And I kept working him and finally got by him.
Is it better to win here than some of the other places you might win because it's so tough and such an ordeal?
Well, it's good to win anywhere, you know. You come to Rockingham here, and we've had a lot of good luck and a lot of bad luck here, and I'm just tickled to death to win another race.
Okay, well, let's go to Pat Patterson with one of the other stories of today's race.
Well, the man that won a championship today is here. He finished second. Dale, let me be one of the first to congratulate you. You're the 1987 Winston Cup champion, and you finished second today, and that was a good shot for you, too.
Well, it ain't bad. You know, the guys worked hard all year long. It was a great year for us, and, you know, Wrangler and Goodrich carried us all the way, and, you know, it's good to wrap it up here at Rockingham since we didn't do it at Charlotte. And, you know, it's just a good day for us. Everybody's worked hard all year, and, you know, I feel like I could have run Bill down. I got a little anxious there and was running him down, and I lost the car and got in the wall and caused us to mess the car up. Had to adjust on it and get it back to where I could drive it pretty decent, so it was lucky, really, to come back in second.
We've been looking at this hat with Pop on top of it. Let's explain that for the television audience.
Well, it's in commemoration of Raymond Beale's dad died this week, and we all called him Pop around the pits, and somebody worked for Copenhagen. Ed Thrapp had the hats made up, and everybody's been wearing them today, just sort of memory of him.
Dale, on the incident where you did clip the wall, what exactly did happen over there? Did you knock the toe in out that bad?
Well, I just went in the corner too hard and lost it, what started it all, but I caught the right rear with the wall, and it threw the front end back into it and knocked the toe in off, and I'm sure the ball joints and stuff have been in it too, but they adjusted the toe in and got it where it drove pretty decent when we came back to second.
Final question. Are you glad it's over as far as the championship goes?
Well, yeah. You know, we're looking to next year now for our championship goes, but we got two more races this year we'd like to win.
Okay, that's Dale Earnhardt, the 1987 Winston Cup champion. Now let's go to Dave Despain.
And that's a man who will race those last two races of this season just as hard as he did the first two back at Daytona. Remember, he won 6 of the first 8 races this year to start that campaign. I recall something that Darrell Waltrip, who ended up 3rd here today, said earlier this week. He said, back in 1985, I think we were one of the best teams in racing. And nobody remembers this because Bill Elliott went off and won 11 Super Speedway races and became Million Dollar Bill and totally dominated. Well, in 1987, Bill Elliott has had absolutely one of the best teams in stock car racing. This team's won 5 events. They've won $1.2 million, give or take a few bucks, with this victory here this afternoon. And yet again, they have been overshadowed, if you will, by the incredible season-long performance by the man we just heard from, Dale Earnhardt. Earnhardt will be on our next Riverside telecast, of course, coming up in a couple of weeks here as we follow this Winston Cup series right down to the wire. I am very, very impressed
with the fact that Earnhardt went out and raced that car as hard as he did. Impressed but not surprised, because that is the Earnhardt style. He had the championship locked up, and he's still stuck it up in the fence trying to catch old Bill Elliott this afternoon.
He sure did, David.
Gee, that's really on target. He, right to the end, he was willing to take any risk there was to get himself another victory, and get himself another victory he did. Now, a second place on Earnhardt and a victory on Elliott, his fifth of the season, and it marks the fifth time that Ford has been victorious on this racetrack. Earnhardt's efforts here today only overshadowed by the effort of Bill Elliott in those final laps when he decided he was going to put that car up in front, and he just drove away.
We'll be back to take a look at the final rundown on this afternoon's race in just a moment. Give you the final standings on the AC Delco 500 here at the North Carolina Motor Speedway.
Next, get set for the bone-crushing action of World Championship Wrestling, followed by the comedy hit The Newly the Two Beaver, coming up on the Superstation.
Well, the AC Delco 500 here this afternoon was indeed a hard charge for everybody out there on that racetrack. But the True Value Hardware people recognize the hard charger by their point system we alluded to at the top of the show. And there's still some tallying going on. It is unofficial at this point, but it appears Bill Elliott has outcharged Dale Earnhardt by a very narrow margin to win the $1,500 top prize, the $5,000 total payoff from True Value Hardware today. Again, unofficially, to be split this way: Elliott first, Earnhardt second, Labonte third, Shepard fourth, and Waltrip fifth. Those were the five cars that really dominated the event. And is that a confirmation? I believe it is official now. That will be the final standing for the True Value Hard Charger Award for this event. We remind you once again that Dale Earnhardt, with the incredible charge that he has made this season, has already locked up the big prize for the end of the year bonus for True Value. Now let's follow up on some of the other guys who, at the top of the show, told us that they had real reasons to go out and try to win this race. Pat Patterson is standing by with one of those guys right now.
And Morgan Shepherd did have a real reason, and you have a chance to look at it here. His wife, Sonny, and his daughter. Morgan, you went out this afternoon with the idea that you're going to run hard. You got something to prove for next year, and I think you did that today. You really made it work.
Well, I think we made a real effort with Quaker State Buick. We ran right good at the early part of the day, but then the car got loose, and we never seemed to be able to overcome that.
Did you have any thoughts early on in this particular race that, well, why should I run so hard for a team that I'm not going to be with next year? But really, you were trying to showcase what you're capable of, aren't you?
I'm running for this little girl right here.
That's Morgan Shepherd. He's happy with a fourth place finish.
So, and it's all over today. 29 cars were still running. It took 4 hours, 13 minutes, 51 seconds to decide this race in favor of Bill Elliott for his 22nd victory. He had 21 victories now for Super Speedways, one on a road course. And it brings his earnings up to close to $1.25 million in 1987. The average speed today was 118.258 miles per hour, which is considerably off the record for the race of a 126 mile per hour margin. I think that's probably as many cars in the lead lap as we've ever experienced here. It may equal a record. We'll check that for you. And as we came down to the finish, we saw Dale Earnhardt making that dramatic charge to come back up and take second place. But it was certainly Elliott's race at the finish. He had a big margin, and there was no way that Earnhardt could contain that unless there'd been another caution flag to play with. The cars, let's see now, there were eight cautions in the race, eight cautions, and we had only one serious incident out here today. We had 31 lead changes among 10 drivers. I think there's a great testament here to the strength of these automobiles, Lake Speed, as you saw 29 cars running out of the 42 that started.
It really is. It's a credit to the sport, especially the mechanics and the people that put these cars together. It's getting better and better all the time. You're seeing more and more cars finish, and what the results of that is we put on a better race for the people. We're not, you know, when the fans come to a Winston Cup event, they don't expect to see somebody win by a lap. And you know, with some of this nature, they expect to see some paint changed and it'll be a photo finish. And we can provide that most of the time.
An overview from you, John Hayes, about what we've experienced here today.
Well, I think today was sort of like we thought it would be. We knew it would be close. We knew everybody would race hard. We set that up before we started the event, and the drivers didn't let us down a bit. My hat's off to the crew guys. The way they work to get these cars out, the way that they work and scrap to get tires from someone else. And those little things can win races for you and the great pit stops. But I think we saw one of the best races of the year. And it always, it's that cream rises to the top. And you can see the same people that are in the top of the point standings are in the top of this race. And it just proves what great teams we have in NASCAR racing.
We'll take a look at the final standings one more time, just a moment, right after we get this from Dave Despain at the STP Pit Center.
Well, there's a note of finality in everything that I hear here because the championship is clinched. But don't forget, we are going to Riverside, and what I want to watch is Dale Earnhardt going after that record that we alluded to earlier. He needs just two more victories in the two races remaining, a sweep from here on, and he will tie Richard Petty, modern-day single-season victory record of 13. And you know that he's going to be spectacular to watch out at Riverside. I want to see that one.
Taking a look at those final standings, Elliott first, Earnhardt was second with his Chevrolet today behind the Ford, then Darrell Waltrip coming across in third, Terry Labonte in fourth, Morgan Shepherd brings the Buick home in fifth, Kyle Petty's Ford is in sixth, and then it's Buddy Baker in seventh, all in that lead lap. Jeff Bodine, one lap down, is in eighth, Phil Parsons with an excellent finish today in ninth, and it's Joe Ruttman coming across in tenth for the Raymock team, driving for the injured Neil Bonnett. 11th today was Sterling Marlin, and finishing 12th was Rusty Wallace. 13th on the day was Harry Gant, 14th with Richard Petty, and 15th on the field was Schrader. There's Darrell Waltrip with Jessica, his new good luck charm, and she darn near came through for him again today. For all of us here on our TBS broadcast, for Lake Speed and for Johnny Hayes, for our pit reporters, Pat Patterson and Jerry Garrett and Dave Despain, I'm Ken Squire saying,